रेडी
इक्विटी
वेदर
थे।
दैट प्लीज एक्सप्लेन द भारत बॉन्ड स्टफ यू नो सो दैट
ओके टिल देन आई कैन जस्ट टॉक अ बिट अबाउट भारत बॉन्ड्स अगेन। तो भारत बॉन्ड्स व्हाई वर दे एक्चुअली क्रिएटेड बिकॉज गवर्नमेंट वांटेड टू get some liquidity for the retail investors into the debt markets. As I told you the other day, the debt markets are mainly for the institutions and the HNI because the minimum ticket sizes are too huge. I mean, they start with 10 lakhs and 1 crore kind of a ticket size. Retail investors just did not understand, and if you want to be a part of a bond which is issued by a government entity like a NABARD or a PS or a PFC, REC kind of things, so just generally there was no scope for us to get into them unless you are going through them through a mutual fund. Bharat Bond is nothing but it's a kind of a mutual fund only, a debt mutual fund, but it's in the form of an ETF. Many of you know about ETF is an exchange traded fund which is actually traded. It follows an index. It's already told which index will it follow. Let's say there is a Nifty ETF which will follow a Nifty index. So whatever is happening to Nifty, the same value will be reflected in your ETF. So if you are unsure as to what, which stocks you should pick or which mutual funds you should pick, and just know that, okay, Nifty is a good thing to be in because long term mein Nifty to badhna hi hai. So just go with a Nifty ETF. You can also do a Nifty index fund. There are subtle differences between the two, which probably we can cover when we are covering mutual funds in detail. But just like equity had an ETF, they also thought let's have debt also, the ETF in debt segment also, fixed income segment as well. So they put up around 15, 16 bonds issued by only the government entities into this Bharat bond. And obviously there were two tranches which were issued. As of now, there are going to be more issues in Bharat bond coming up later, probably later this year or next year. Because once this is successful, probably they would be, government would be looking to get more into Bharat bond stuff. So there were two tranches, one with a maturity of 3 years and one with a maturity of 10 years. So in the 3 years one, they had all the papers which were maturing after 3 years and some few months, and then the 10 years and few months for the other tranche. And they had initially told that, okay, if you hold this till maturity, you are going to get X percentage as your returns. So that was around 7.5% for 10 years and 6.7% for 3 years. Now what happens is that if the, as I told you, the bond prices and yields are inversely related. If the interest rate goes down, and interest rate actually went down in January and February, so the prices of these bonds actually, which were issued at 1,000 rupees, it's just like an IPO price which starts at 1,000. They just kept on increasing, and it went till 1,050, 1,060 in no time. It's not an equity like UK, like IRCTC that they or a DMart. 300 pe issue hua, 600 chala gaya. It's a bond. It had to gradually increase, but because of the movement in the yields up and down, that interest rate keeps happening. The bond prices will also move up and down. But whosoever is a long-term player can hold that for 3 year or a 10 year, depending upon which tranche he has chosen, and can get that 7.5 or 6.7% returns. So that's Bharat Bond. If you have any specific questions on Bharat Bond, you can ping me separately, because today I don't want to take the equity and the mutual fund time for discussing what we had already discussed.
Thank you, Vaibhav.
So Bhavya, just ping me separately if you want. Yashwant, are you ready?
Yeah, I'm done. So as Vaibhav rightly said, you know, day four of a test match probably is the most critical and defines how the test match has been progressing so far.
Okay, I can see that today's PPT, Suman. Are you all guys able to see see today's PPT on screen now?
Or Mukul, probably they would like to have it on
great.
A WhatsApp group. If you can
great.
Share the PDF on
I'm
the
sure the
WhatsApp
stock market
group
discussions everybody would be waiting for.
Yes, yes. I'm sharing the PDF on WhatsApp group in some time. I think my screen is visible, right?
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, great.
Okay, sure.
So I'm sharing in just 2 minutes. Just give me 2 minutes.
Okay, done. So if we can move to the next slide, Mukul.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, Mukul, can you go to the slideshow?
Amit, we can discuss this, but we need more details here. What is your age today? I mean, obviously you had filled that form, but I need to recheck. If you are 35 today and want to retire by 40, 45, the answer would be completely different if you're 20. But 40, okay. 45 में retire होके घर चले तो तुम्हारी income should be somewhere around a crore in, if not now, probably in 2-3 years. Assuming you are 25 today.
Agreed. 45 retirement is quite ambitious, must say. But let's hope you can, you know, achieve that easily. I'll just take a quick 1 minute revision into
Wait, so the. So you're doing your MBA? You have to. You are already doing, or you are planning to do MBA now? Oh, great. We'll take this separately, yeah, because personally discussing this in chat doesn't make much sense. But you know what, we'll discuss few case studies kind of thing, which you can relate to yourselves and think that if you want to achieve the kind of goal you had said, you have said, what should you do? Just nothing. It's just basic class 10th, class 8th mathematics. Yeah. It's just reverse calculation karna hai with so many assumptions in your life. So if you're 23 today, and you want to retire at 45. So in 22 years, how much value you should amass for yourself, so that you and your family can sustain for, you can sustain for, assuming your life till 75. You can sustain 30 years, your wife can sustain 30 years, and your kids are there, blah, blah, blah. Bahut sare kharche hote hain. So, har kharche ko pura karne ke liye, how much you should have by the age of 45, so that you can peacefully retire. So, bahut sare cheeze, calculations and all we need to do generally. These are some real life problems, you know. Amit, which I go and talk to people, they generally have these kind of scenarios. Sometimes I feel that they are very, very, they're expecting too much out of it. Not feasible kind of a thing. So my goal is to actually get them to back to reality. Any other questions from yesterday's session till Yashwant, intervene whenever you are ready, boss.
Okay? Yeah, I'm ready, Vibha. I thought you were explaining to Amit, so. Okay. So.
Yep, that's what I'm saying.
That, you know, regarding asset allocation, how you should structure according to your risk profile, we'll take up a couple of sample case studies. Vibha, we'll take that up tomorrow. So that would be like the conclusion to this entire exercise or this entire course. If we quickly go through this slide again once more, I know that we have repeated this slide a couple of times, but it is important to understand that on a risk reward graph, if you plot all the possible assets that are there in the market currently, cash, FDs, savings account, recurring deposits, they are the safest instruments, followed by government bonds. And we discussed the different types of fixed income instruments yesterday. Today, we are going to discuss the entire gamut of equity investing. Okay, and these are, you know, before I begin the course, I would like to say, and most of you would already be knowing that these are.
Yeah, Yashwant, even I can't hear you if in case you are speaking.
Is it okay now?
मुझे तो clearly नहीं, बिल्कुल भी नहीं सुनाई दे.
Just a second.
Yashwant sir, I can hear you, but it's quite low.
Hello.
Okay, meanwhile, one more thing, guys. That form, I hope everybody has filled in. I had done some analysis.
Is it better now?
And probably by tonight or tomorrow most probably.
Okay.
Okay, great. Yeah, so I think I can.
Technological errors.
I'll shut up then.
So again, just to repeat the last point, equity is a risky area to venture into, okay? And you can expect good returns with a good amount of risk. Mukul, if you can move to the next slide. Okay, so before we begin a deeper discussion into equities, would like to, you know, speak about what actually shares are. Now, some of you might be thinking, nah, this is such a basic thing everyone knows. But trust me, over the last years that I've been in the market and I've been discussing it with people, there are certain basic concepts that most people are not aware of. And they're happily unaware of the fact that they're not aware of these basic concepts. And there are a couple of typical errors we can avoid, you know, if we kind of know about these concepts. So just to rush things,
what are shares? When a company form, you know, first of all, there's a partnership kind of a company, you know, when me and Rahul and Vaibhav are partners in this currently today, okay? So any liability arising out of this can be charged individually to each of the persons, okay? My personal assets can be attached in case I, you know, enter into a partnership firm and I default over there, okay? But when you form a company, it's formed, first of all, by more people rather than just three, okay? And everyone's liability is limited. Now, that is the most important concept of a company. If a company goes into default, the shareholders cannot be called upon to pay anything other than the value of the shares that, you know, they were supposed to be paying and they did not pay. Apart from that, they cannot be called to pay anything. So that is the most important thing to understand when you're dealing with companies and when you're dealing with equities. So since there are so many multiple people, you know, investing into equities, can run from 10 people, 5 people, probably 5, 10 people, to into 5, 10,000 people to even 10 crores people, right? So what they do is they divide the entire capital of the company into multiple smaller tranches of equal value. Each such tranche is called a share. Simply dividing the capital requirement into smaller units. Okay. This makes it easy for multiple people to invest into the company and have a standard process of, you know, who is holding how much. Two common fallacies that we have seen people know, not know about is ownership and management of a company are different. For instance, you as a shareholder of a company, as a shareholder of Reliance today, technically, even if I'm holding one share, I'm a partial owner in Reliance. Okay. Similarly, I might be holding 1 lakh shares. Even that doesn't give me a lot of value in or a lot of stake in Reliance, right? The ownership of a company and the management of a company are different. If you take the case of, let's say, a professionally owned company, like you can take the case of Infosys. The promoters of Infosys, the 7 founders of Infosys, never held more than 35-40% stake combined in Infosys. Okay. Yet they were running the management team of Infosys. They were not the majority shareholders. So the key point to understand over here is the person who owns the shares does not run the company. And the person who runs the shares, I mean, who runs the company, runs it on behalf of the people who own the who own the shares. The second point I've already discussed. Now there are 3 kind of investors in every company. First is the promoter. Who started of the company? Kiska brainchild tha ye? And promoter group. Now, for multiple reasons, you know, in Infosys' case, there were 7 founders. Okay, so it became a group by default. But in the case of Reliance, it was started by Dhirubhai Ambani himself, right? But even then, a promoter group was defined. Reason being, since each shareholder has a limited liability, what most people do is they divide their overall shareholding in such a way that the entire family or the close-knit friends, etc., own a particular portion of the shares. So today, Mukesh Ambani directly may not be holding the entire stake that he holds in Reliance, but through his wife, through his children, through various trusts and other private companies that he forms, he will be owning much more shares. Okay, so that is called the entire promoter and promoter group. As per the law in the country currently, no company can have more than 75% promoter shareholding other than a government company. There are a couple of exceptions which currently have more than 75% promoter holding, but they have already been mandated by SEBI to bring down their holdings in the next few years. The next important people are the institutional investors, which could be the foreign institutional investors or the domestic institutional investors. These are banks, insurance companies, other sovereign funds, hedge funds, the mutual funds, etc. People who, entities which invest, you know, in the capacity of an institution rather than individual capacity. And then the last share is of retail people, which might include HNIs, which are high net worth individuals, people who invest a lot of money, and the common public. So that was about the kind of investors that are there in a company. The basic value of a share is the face value. इस पे ज्यादा डिस्कशन नहीं करेंगे, जस्ट वन ऑफ द कॉमन पॉइंट्स दैट आई मेंशन इन केस यू नो इट कम्स अप लेटर इन डिस्कशन. व्हेन आई स्टार्ट ऑफ यू नो स्टार्ट ऑफ अ कंपनी एंड आई डिवाइड माय एंटायर कैपिटल इनटू शेयर्स, आई असाइन अ बेसिक अ वेरी बेसिक वैल्यू टू ईच शेयर. दैट बेसिक वैल्यू दैट आई असाइन टू ईच यूनिट इज कॉल्ड द फेस वैल्यू. दैट्स ऑल दैट इज इंपॉर्टेंट टू अंडरस्टैंड. ओके मुकुल, कैन यू मूव टू द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड प्लीज. Okay, IPOs have been the flavor of the market over the last 3-4 years. What's an IPO? IPO is an initial public offer. When a company approaches the stock markets for the first time to list itself, it has to launch what they call as an initial public offer, which means the company is offering its existing shares or new shares to the public to subscribe to it. But when it's doing the first time, it's an initial public offer. There are two kinds of initial public offers that can be there, and it is very important to understand the difference between the two. Let us take the case of a company like let's take the case of IRCTC. Okay, when IRCTC came up with its IPO, the central government was the only owner in IRCTC. And IRCTC did not actually want a lot of capital to, you know, fund its future expansion. The only money that was being raised by the IPO was the money that the government wanted to exit out of the company, partial exit rather. So whatever amount we subscribed for in IRCTC did not go to the company. That money went to the existing shareholders. Agar main company ka ek khata maintain karu, okay, in very basic terms. कि आज के दिन उस कंपनी में कौन कौन शेयरहोल्डर्स है. ओके, इफ वैभव रिप्लेसेस मी, राहुल रिप्लेसेस वैभव, मुकुल रिप्लेसेस राहुल, सो एवरी डे द नेम्स ऑफ बेनिफिशियल ओनर्स ऑफ शेयर्स इन द कंपनी चेंजेस. बट व्हेन राहुल एंड मुकुल आर ट्रेडिंग बिटवीन देमसेल्व्स, द कंपनी इज नॉट इन्वॉल्व. कंपनी के थ्रू पैसा नहीं जा रहा. स्टॉक मार्केट में जो भी ट्रेडिंग होती है, दैट ट्रेडिंग does not happen through the company. It is just two shareholders exchanging hands with or without the company being known knowing about it. If an existing investor is selling its stake in the market, it is known as an offer for sale. Okay, or if a company is coming up with an IPO in which it is taking capital, the initial capital, and using that money for its expansion, for its working capital, etc. In that case, that particular portion of the money is going to the company. The rest of it is going in exiting of existing shareholders. So whenever we apply to an IPO, this is one thing that we need to take care of. So I'd just like to reiterate this point. After an IPO, all trading activity that takes place on exchanges are secondary market trades, and no money goes to the company at all. Share capital of the company remains constant. Only shareholders keep changing. And now that brings me to the most important lesson in stock markets. I can buy whenever it's always a zero-sum trade game. For instance, whenever I want to buy the stocks of Bajaj Finance, an existing shareholder needs to sell that stock to me. Okay, Ajay, I will keep that in mind. I'll talk only in English. Yeah, Amit, I will explain this point. So, I'll just repeat this last point. Whenever I am buying a share, if I want to buy a share, I can buy it only when an existing shareholder wants to sell it. Similarly, whenever I want to exit from a company, I can exit if and only if somebody else is willing to buy the share of that particular company. This is an important point on which we'll have an entire slide to itself. At the end of the day, it's a zero-sum game. right? Just to explain that point on IPO again, see, when an IPO comes out, there's something called a red herring prospectus or a basic description of what the entire details of the IPO are, the entire past details of the company are. Over there, you will find what the company intends to do with the money that is being raised in the IPO. For instance, if IRCTC, I don't remember the exact amount, but for hypothetical purposes, if IRCTC wants to come up with an IPO of 10,000 crores, how will the company use that 10,000 crores? First of all, will that amount go to the company completely or partially? That would be mentioned in that red herring prospectus. Secondly, if some of that amount is going to an existing shareholder just to retire them as a shareholder, that will also be mentioned. So whether it is an offer for sale or a new money IPO or a mixture of both, that will be clearly mentioned in the red herring prospectus or in any news article that you read about it. Hope that answers. Mukul, can we go to the next slide? Yeah, Rahul, exactly. Chittorgarh.com is one of the best sites where all details of IPO are discussed. That's one of the very good sites to, you know, keep referring to. Again, quick 1 minute on this slide. How are stock prices determined? Since I already told you, it is always a zero-sum game. If I am buying, somebody else has to sell. If I want to sell, somebody else has to buy. Otherwise, that trade doesn't happen. So stock prices are determined purely basis demand and supply. Two important things need to be taken care of. I want to sell 100 shares of ITC. I can sell that only when somebody else wants to buy 100 shares of ITC. Apart from that, there's another provider. I want to sell ITC at 190. But the buyer does not want to buy it at 190. He wants to buy it at a cheaper rate. So no trade will take place till the time somebody comes up to negotiate. How that negotiation is done in the real markets, we'll look that up in the next slide.
Yashwant, web of this side.
Yeah, Web.
Can I just intervene for a second?
Yeah, please.
Guys, sorry, my mic was not working, so I could not come in the last slide. But what I wanted to say is that what Yashwant was trying to explain, so IPOs generally are either 100%, which is they are when they are selling their existing stake. The primary example here is, as Salman Modak has also written, Sterling and Wilson Solar. But in 2017, which was a bumper year for the IPOs, most of the IPOs were only secondary sale. So whenever you see, whenever the market is just going up and up and up, whenever the secondary market is doing good, you know, the normal stock market, what existing promoters and existing owners will try to do is that they will want to sell their stake to the other retailers or institutions or HNIs. If the IPO is, let's say, 1,000 crore size, and the entire 1,000 crore some existing shareholder is selling to a new shareholder, which Yashwant explained, is called a complete, called a 100% secondary offer or an OFS. But then there was a very good example in 2017, which was a 100% primary. The owner was not taking anything. He just wanted to raise new money for expanding its operations. Any guess which company that was? That was DMart. DMart 100% primary, 100% new money came into the company. And you see what's, I mean, really it's an analysis whether you should also, if you're going to keep a very, very close eye, this IPO is good or not, generally try to see which promoter is selling stake and which promoter is raising fresh money. But I think most of the IPOs are generally a mix of this, just like IRCTC, where they wanted to also raise new money through creating new shares, and government wanted to sell. So I just wanted to give the DMart wala example, otherwise all good. So Yashwant, sorry, continue.
Thanks, Abhav. So that's the perfect example, actually, DMart. And we can all see how successful that is. So when you want to buy a IPO for listing gain, first of all, you need to go to chittorgarh.com. or similar sites and check out all the details regarding past financials, who the current promoters are, who the current shareholders are, what the market is, etc. And second, what they are doing with the shares. If the promoter himself is exiting with the money that you are giving it to him, and after his exit, he will hardly be left with any stake in the company. Be aware of such companies.
he's exiting, he must be knowing certain things because of which he's exiting. So Mukul, if you can go to the next slide. Yeah, so this is one slide we'll take 5 minutes on.
Yeah, Nishit. So this is one slide we'll take 5 minutes on. How stock prices are actually determined. Okay. If you use the site Money Control or you use any other site, you will commonly hear this word called market depth. Market depth captures nothing but how much of demand is there and how much of supply is there. Quantity and value-wise both. Okay. So let us take the case of a company, the share price of which is trading around 200 rupees. Okay. The market opens at 9:15. I enter a quantity, you know, I want to buy 1,000 shares of that company. I call up my broker and say, I want to buy 1,000 shares at 200.5. Okay. Similarly, there are so many other people in the world who want to buy that company shares. If you look at the list, 1,600, 1,100, 650, 25,000, the first five against 9:15 timing. So those represent the amount of buyers that are willing to buy shares of that particular company. The quantity and the rate at which they want to buy is mentioned. Similarly, there'll be a time when sellers are also available in the market. Somebody is available to sell 1,000 shares at 200.5. Then there are 400, sellers who want to sell 400. 600, 10,000 and five shares only at different prices. So what happens is the National Stock Exchange and the BSE also has similar software, but the National Stock Exchange has a software called NEET. Okay. It's an automated exchange system. Whenever you enter this kind of an order, either through your broker or, you know, by calling up your broker or directly entering into the software, the trading app that is there, that gets fetched up by the NEET system and it makes a list of all the orders, the buy orders and the sell orders, and it populates them in this order. The order is a person who is willing to buy the share at the highest price will be given first preference, because everyone wants to buy stock at lower prices, right? If somebody has the guts of, you know, or the willingness to buy stock at the higher price, he'll be given first preference. Similarly, everyone wants to sell at a high price. So preference will be given to those people who want to sell at a lower price. So that's how the buying order and the selling order, that entire stack is arranged by the NEET system. And whenever for a particular price, okay, let's say in the first example, it's 200.50. Somebody is ready to buy at that price and somebody is ready to sell at that price. At that price, the order will be executed. And the number of shares that actually get executed depends on whichever is the lower amount. So in this case, in our first example, somebody is ready to buy 1,000 shares at 200.5. Somebody is ready to sell 1,000 shares at 200.5. So an entire volume of 1,000 shares get traded at the price 200.5. And the price that you actually see in the market on CNBC is 200.5, which is the LTP, or what it means is the last traded price. At what price did the last trade actually happen? So this was the scene at 9:15. At 9:30, what happens is a similar trade happens, but only of 100 quantity. At 200.6, there's a buyer available, and at 200.6, a seller is available. So what happens is another trade gets executed, this time not for 1,000 shares, but for 100 shares. And the last traded price of the market increases to 200.6. So between 9:15 and 9:30, the price of the stock has already increased from 200.5 to 200.6. At 9:45, now, here comes the mismatch. Buyer is available at 200.4. For 600 quantity. Similarly, that entire rack is arranged sellers are available at 200. Now you would ask, when somebody is ready to buy at a higher price, why will somebody sell at a lower price? That's because when I'm ordering, you know, I'm putting an order into my system, I don't know what other people are entering an order at. So what Nifty does is, Nifty matches my order with the best available order in the market. So the best available buyer in the market is at 200.4. I enter that I want to sell stock at 200. So what Nifty does is, between these two, 200 and 200.4, my trade will get executed. And the quantity will be the lower of the buy quantity or the sell quantity. So 600 shares in this example will get executed somewhere between 200 and 200.4. And the last traded price of the market would be, it could be 200 or 200.4 or anything in between, wherever the last trade executes. And at 10 a.m., there are buyers available at 200.15, 199.55, etc. And then there this person comes up who wants to sell 30,000 shares. There are two kinds of orders. Whenever you place order into your app or whenever you call your broker, there are two ways you can do it. One is called a limit order. I want to buy 100 shares of DMart at 2,200. I am defining my price, 2,200 exact. Okay. Or I can just say, I want to buy 100 shares of DMart. I don't care whether it's 5 rupees up or 5 rupees down. Right. So in that case, I just want to buy the shares. I want to, exhibit an urgency of buying it. I'll enter a market order. A market order is whatever price is available, execute my order. Okay. Whenever you trade in real life, please try to avoid market order when you are doing trading, short-term trades. When you are buying stocks for long-term and you don't really care whether, you know, whether you buy 10 rupees up or 10 rupees down, in that case, you can execute or you can put in a market order. So just to quickly cover this up, the last trade will happen at 200.15 and 200. Why 200? Because that was the last traded price in the market. Somebody is ready to buy at 200.15. Okay. And somebody is ready to sell at whatever price is available. So although I am ready to buy at 200.15, the market will give me an advantage. Ki bhai, you wanted to buy at 200.15? I'll give you an option of buying at a lower price also, because there's a seller available who says, sell my shares at whatever price available. So in such a scenario, my cost price generally improves. So many times you will find in your contract note that you had entered to buy at a particular price and you actually were able to buy at a lower price. That is because the need system automatically adjusts itself in such a way that, you know, your prices are optimized. Okay. So that is how the entire gamut of stock price determination happens. So when you see that the stock price is increased, it only means that somebody has bought the share at that particular higher price. When the price decreases, somebody has sold the share at that particular price. Okay. And buyers and sellers are available above or below that particular price only. Mukul, can you move to the next slide?
Yashwan?
Yeah, Vaibhav.
Why don't you just, after this slide or your section, just go to NSE or BSE website and show them how to see this, this table, market depth table. And probably these guys can have as an assignment somewhere between market hours tomorrow, can check any stocks market depth table. So probably they might be interested in seeing a live example.
That's a really good idea, Vaibhav. So,
but you can do it afterwards, because you would need to share your screen or something like that. Probably towards the end, we can do that.
Yeah. So, Weber, Rahul is planning to share his screen for doing the fundamental analysis section. Rahul?
Mm-hmm. That time we can probably cover.
So, just before we move on, having discussed these common technicalities and this common basics about the stock market, we'll proceed with the rest of the session. But I just want to give you a small disclaimer. Investing in stocks is an art and you cannot learn it in 2 hours. You cannot learn it even in 20 years. No one is an expert in it. But there are certain basic things apart from the terminology that you need to learn. Those basic things are the principles. You know, that entire principle basis which you invest in the markets, the entire principle basis which you construct your portfolio. If you put your principles right, the markets will respect you and you will gain. However knowledgeable you might be, if you don't follow your principles and if there's a lack of discipline, trust me, you're not going to make money in the long run. Okay. So this course is on personal finance management. Okay. As part of the course outline, I thought, you know, let's, more than teaching people what basics of investing are, how to find out what a good stock is. Of course, we'll be discussing that, but everyone has a different view on that. Okay. And that is why, because of which there is a market. Somebody is buying and somebody is selling. Okay. Doesn't mean that the buyer is, you know, losing and the seller is gaining or vice versa. It only means X person is not confident on something, Y person is. And that confidence is being derived from the same material. So just to reiterate the point that there is no right or wrong in market, but there is a set of principles mostly hovering around your personal discipline. If you can maintain that, you are a lead, you know, you will gain in the market. If you cannot, you will not. So let's try to discuss some of those things. The basic question that people have asked me so far, not exactly in this course, but other places where I have discussed these things. How do I achieve mastery over the markets? So I would like to quote Sachin Tendulkar. He said, "No one is ever bigger than the game." People might be calling him God, but he believes he is not bigger than the game. Which means what? Market is always the best and the biggest teacher around. The moment you feel that you have learned 100% things in the market will show, you know, its cards, and it will be a kind of a thug life moment for the markets. There is a famous quote which is, the more you learn, the more you realize how much more there is to learn. So if you look at interviews or videos of some of the market gurus, they will never be discussing individual stock picking strategies. All they will be discussing is the principles and how they have continuously kept themselves abreast of all the market developments that are going around. How you need to learn and learn and learn every day and improve yourself. So if you ever believe you are 100% confident about a particular company that, you know, it's very good in the long run, or you want to do a trade and you are very sure that I'll get profit out of this trade, if you are so sure, there is a possibility. I'm not saying you're wrong, but there's a possibility that in your confidence, you might have missed out on some of the basic details. So whenever you feel so confident about something, just go back and check if you have missed out on something. Mukul, if you can go to the next slide. So let's accept that we cannot learn from the markets. I mean, we cannot achieve mastery over the markets. We can only learn from it. And as they say, wise men learn from others' mistakes, fools from their own. So out of the 45-50 people that are there right now, there is one fool that I can help you identify, and that is me. More than 10 years in the market and I have lost heavily. I may or may not know exactly what is the best way to analyze a stock. I have done some pretty good analysis in the past, but I know 1,000 ways how to lose money in the stocks. And basis those learnings that I've had, I would like to share some lessons with you. So this course will begin, go on more like a lesson kind of a format. Certain things mostly not to be done. And then towards the end, we'll cover certain basic things to be done to achieve satisfactory results in the market. Quoting what Modi ji said, currently said in the before announcing the last lockdown was, "Jaan hai to jahan hai." Speaking of that in market terms, capital protection is the key. No matter how good a trade appears, opportunities can go and come and go. If you're not confident, skip it. Protect your capital. You will, you know, you can always live to die another day. Mukul, the next slide, please. Mukul. Thank you. Mukul, are you there? Yeah, next one. So I named the previous slide as death traps. If you look at this particular graph, how many times, Mukul, previous slide pe jana. How many times have people given you tips, or you know, you have got messages, buy stocks of XYZ company expected to double in 10 days. It's continuously hitting the upper circuit. It will double or triple or you know, increase 50% in the next 5, 7, 10 days. Whenever you get such tips, I've seen a lot of people invest into it. In the, you know, read of making money quickly, do not do that. Somebody asked me that question, what is the difference between share capital and market cap? Share capital means the actual amount of equity capital and reserves and surplus that you can see on the balance sheet of the company, which Rahul will show to you towards the end of the session. Market cap means how many shares, they suppose there are 10 crore shares of a company listed in the market. The current price of the share, each share is 200 rupees. So 10 into 200 crore, which is 2000 crore is the market cap of a company. The higher the market cap of a company, the more traded it is and the more liquid it is. And we define stocks by large cap, small cap, mid cap, basis the market cap. That cap is the capitalization over there. Yeah. Typical, the largest company in the country currently is TCS with a market cap of more than 7 lakh crores. Penny stocks are companies which generally have market cap below 1000 crores. Unless you are very, 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 very sure about that company fundamentally from a long-term perspective, do not invest in penny stocks, because there might be a game going on behind in those penny stocks which you are not aware of. Liquidity is a very important factor. In the previous slide, we saw buyers and sellers at 200.5 and 200.6. So that gap between 200.5 and 200.6 is the bid-ask spread. 10 paise ka gap. Only 10 paise ka gap, right? It is very low in case of a highly traded company. But the gap is very high in case of a poorly traded company, in case of a penny stock. A buyer would be standing at 180 and the seller would be at 220, which means there can never be a trade that can happen between these two till the time a person intervenes and says, I want to buy it at 200, and the seller comes and says, I want to buy it at 200 or whatever price that might be. So you need to avoid stocks that do not have a good bid-ask spread, that do not have a good liquidity. The buyers and the sellers should be at similar positions. Stocks with very low volumes and stocks which have a lot of fluctuating promoter holding, they are susceptible to a lot of price manipulation. There are operators sitting in the market, some HNI sitting over there, some brokers sitting over there who are playing with the money. And always remember, the money that they gain are the money that somebody else is losing, because it's always a zero-sum game. So let us not be that particular person. There's this concept of upper circuit. Upper circuit means there's a lot of demand, but there is no one to sell. Only buyers. If that situation happens, stocks will go and hit that upper circuit. Now for most stocks in the market, the circuit levels are defined basis categorization. Now there are different categories that SEBI has put around each of the stocks, okay, depending on certain parameters. So for certain stocks, there might be a 5% or a 10% or a 15% or a 20% daily circuit level. That determination of circuit level is mainly basis what is the market cap of the company, how large it is, and what is the volume, the regular volume that has been traded. Okay. In larger companies, there is no circuit, which is why you see stocks like Yes Bank, IndusInd Bank, etc., etc., have been recently moving upwards and downwards in excess of 20%. So they don't have circuits. But the smaller companies always have circuits. Similarly, there's a lower circuit, which means everyone is willing to sell, no one is ready to buy. Even if you sell your stocks at a discount, people will not be there to buy the stocks. Okay. This is how, Mukul, the next slide, please. If you look at this
graph. Yashant, one more thing.
Yeah, yeah.
So guys, there are few stocks which are there in F&O, which are derivatives, futures and options market. And those are time to time decided by SEBI. So whichever stocks are there in F&O, only the large stocks, as Yashant was mentioning, only the large and liquid stocks are generally moved towards the F&O segment. So only those F&O stocks will have no circuits. All the other stocks which are not in F&O will have the circuits thing. And for example, you can see the Vodafone share currently is trading between 3 to 4 rupees. Generally, you would think chota share hai, it's a small share, it's a 3 or 4 rupees. Although market cap might also have reduced, but still is that is there in F&O market. So it has no circuit. That is why sometimes you see even like yesterday, you saw 25-26% up move in Vodafone stock. And someone is asking, how is it defined circuit limits? Yashant, would you want to take it?
Yeah, so thank you. Circuit limits are defined, as I just said, basis primarily 3-4 factors. The first factor is what is the market cap of the company, whether it's a small cap or a micro cap company or a medium cap, mid cap company or a large cap company. Okay, that is one factor. Second is how much volume is regularly traded in a company, which means there might be a company which has a good 10,000 crore of market cap, but there is no trade that is happening in that company. So basis average of, last X number of days, there's a whole complicated formula behind it. Dependent on these factors, SEBI determines whether it will be in the 5% or the 10% or the 15% category or the 20% category. And these categories also have other limits. For instance, I can move 20% in a day, but I cannot move more than 60% in a week. So if you move 20% on 2-3 days, the next day your circuit limit is revised to 5% or 10%. So there's this entire science and the mathematics behind it, which SEBI takes care of. So typically, since these are so complicated things, a lay investor who is not into the business of making money. Remember, we are not into the business of making money. We are into the business of managing our money. So we should avoid such kind of companies where we are not sure what exactly is going on. Typically, I just picked up a random company, Steel Exchange. Okay. It's one of those penny companies that, I got a message of, invest in this company. I did not invest because I had learned my lesson by then. But then I thought it would be a good thing to capture for my class. Okay. If you look at the stock is the graph. Somewhere from the end of October, the last week of October, till the first week of November, the stock price increased from 70 rupees to 130, 140 within 1 month. This, trust me, is an example of a weekly rising prices. Matlab, prices were not rising a lot. There are graphs when it is even more steep. The upward movement is steeper. How this happens is there is a promoter and an operator working side by side. The operator asks every one of his clients and other people around to spread the message that buy the share, buy the share, buy the share. So when they are buying the share, somebody else is selling it. Who is selling it? The promoter is selling it. Either directly or through the operator. Now, if he does directly, then it comes out in some cases in the news after certain levels, or he may be doing it through the operator. Before this upward movement starts, let's say the promoter holds 75%, okay, and 25% is held by the public. You will generally not find institutional investors in such companies. When it starts moving up, retailers are buying shares, retail public are buying shares, and promoters are exiting. Probably, hypothetically, by the end of this exercise, promoter shareholding is reduced to 50%. Now retailers are at another 50%. At one particular point, the promoter will say, no, I don't want to do anything else. If he is not buying the stock, okay, you want to sell it now. See, till now, you were buying the stock and he was selling. Now you want to sell because you wanted to make quick money. Now you want to exit. There is no one to buy the stock because every one of the retail investors bought the stock only to enjoy this upward benefit. And the promoter is in no mood to buy the stock. So what happens is people start selling at discount. There's a huge demand, only sellers available. Every day there is a lower circuit. And as the law of gravitation works out, the gravitation pull is always higher on the downside, right? The way the stock prices are moving up, they will always fall faster than they move up, always. And the volume will, if you look at the graph of volume below, volume determines how many shares are bought and sold. The volume will probably be the highest when it reaches the peak, because by that time the promoter has completely, or the operator has completely exited. You will not be able to make this exit. If you had bought the stock even at 70, okay, which is the beginning of the rising period, the stock price would have definitely fallen below 70. It falls below 60. Okay. So you will always be at a loss in such kind of an investments. So if any stock offers you a quick return, please be very careful, especially if it is a low market cap company with a very low volume. Okay. If you look at the past, there is hardly any volume in this company. If you look at 5th October, 23rd October, there's hardly any volume. And after 7th December, there's no volume at all. Suman, this is a small cap company, a very, very, very small cap company, typically with a market capitalization below 1000 crore. We are not experts and we are not in the business of making so much of money, quick money. Let's be happy with whatever little we are getting. Let's avoid such kind of companies. And there'll be no way to recover the money that you lose over here. So this was the first things not to be done. I'll just see if there are any questions. See, every listed company is regulated by SEBI, but understand one thing, that there are 3000 plus listed companies, plus there's a whole gamut of SME segment of listed companies. It is practically not possible for SEBI to look at what is happening in each company. They'll regulate the bigger companies, and SEBI is not wrong in doing so, that they are not regulating each of the smaller companies, or they are regulating post facto, post this entire exercise has happened. Because when you are investing, SEBI makes sure that you know, or you know, you hear this thing, investment in stock markets is subject to risks. Now, if you know, I am deliberately trying to jump off a cliff, you know, trying to risk a, you know, having a parachute, and the parachute doesn't work and I fall down and die, it's not the fault of the government, it's my fault. Right? So let's, whether or not SEBI regulates it, it's a law that we are making. Next slide, Mukul, please. So there are two, three lessons that we directly learned from this. First, there is no free meal. You should not buy stocks, whether small cap or large cap or mid cap, depend basis only the stock tips given by a particular person. There's an insider news. Do it. See, the graph of companies in which, you know, an insider tip is coming out, even though it is a large cap company, the graph might still look the same. The company gives out, or the person who is giving out that insider news to you is giving out one part of the news. Share prices are determined by 1000 other things. So do not buy a stock just for, you know, for the sake of buying. Again, there is no quick meal. Always run after longer term money, not after short term money. Liquidity is the friend of the cautious investor. Please avoid penny stocks. And do not try to copy your neighbor. My neighbor made money. My friend made money in steel exchange. He bought at 70, he sold at 90. Okay. But had he held on to it, he would have lost money. Had I tried to copy him, because you can only copy a person after he has done his part. And by that time, it might be too late. So don't try to copy somebody. Have your own investing style. Next slide, please, Mukul. Till the time Mukul is just changing the slide, I'll just see in case there are questions. Yeah, so Vaibhav has been answering. Thanks. Okay. So earlier we read, Jaan hai to Jahan hai. But then Modi ji changed his pattern and said, Jaan bhi Jahan bhi. I want health and economy both. So we need capital protection that's something we necessarily need. Even Warren Buffett said, there are two rules. First rule is, don't lose money. Second rule is, don't forget rule number one. So capital protection is must. Apart from that, if we can get capital appreciation, is best. So now we'll discuss what is the importance of cap portfolio construction and diversification. Mukul, next slide, please. So you would have often heard people saying, or people wondering, you know, in retrospect, everyone is a king. Had I bought Bajaj Finance in 2009, or had I bought this particularly wonderful stock in 2009, I would have made millions by now. But tell me, how many people actually knew that it would be, you know, it would rise from 7 rupees a stock to close to 4,000 or 5,000 in 10 years? And even if somebody was able to predict that, do you really think that person would have held on an investment at 7 rupees and he would have held on to it till 5,000? He would have sold it somewhere in between, you know, and multiple people would have bought and sold in between. So it's very easy to say that had I picked the best stock in the market, I would have become a millionaire by now. In practical life, it is not possible to do so. In my years of experience, there are certain stocks which have given me amazing multi-bagger returns. Okay. But however bit of knowledge I have about markets, or however experience I would have had, there was a bit of fear in me. And I invested only a small portion of my portfolio into those companies. They gave me 7 times, 10 times, 15 times return. But the amount was insignificant because the very small amount that I invested in those. Okay. So we'll now discuss the most important part of the session probably, is how to make sure that your portfolio is constructed in such a manner that, one, you don't miss out on the big returns that these good companies can offer. And second, even if you invest in a company and it goes bankrupt, doesn't really matter. Okay, because you're in the business of taking risks. Okay, so I have deliberately chosen 10 companies, okay, of different categories back in 2009. And I would want all of you to go back to 2009. You don't know what the current prices of these stocks are. Only the first line is available to you when there are 10 stocks you want to invest in and your current prices are mentioned over there. At that point in time, like always, I would want to invest in large cap names, mid cap names, and the small cap names. So in 2009, the larger or the more trusted names, you know, large cap is based on trust mostly. The more large cap names were Tata Motors, Reliance Industries, Maruti, ITC, Asian Paints, and Bajaj Auto. Okay. And the smaller names in 2009 were Yes Bank, Reliance Capital, Bajaj Finance. Okay. Jet Airways was still a mid kind of name. So I invested in all of these companies. Okay. Let us assume if I had invested equal amount in each company. Okay. What actually happened? We always suggest in stock markets, please hold on stocks for a long term. 10 years is sufficiently moderate. I would still not say a very long term, but sufficiently moderate to long term kind of a holding period. So I've taken a 10 year analysis. Just pardon one thing. After 2019, I've written now. Okay, so this slide or these prices were taken in December, just before the coronavirus period started. And I didn't really want to update it for coronavirus crisis because, one, it would have changed the data slightly, not majorly. And second, it's unfair to take a decline and not the recovery after that. So the data is updated till December 2019. If we look at Bajaj Finance, it moved up from 7 rupees to 4,000. Asian Paints, 90 rupees to 1,700. The kind of returns that these companies have given. Now, this apart from this capital appreciation, these companies also give dividends, right? So these are my lottery picks, which have given multi-bagger returns. Now there are other stocks like Bajaj Auto, Maruti. These two companies have given me significantly good returns, 10 times kind of returns in 10 years, which is good. Then there are underperformers, companies which have not failed, but definitely not given a good amount of return. Reliance Industries, ITC and Tata Motors. We all know what Tata Motors and ITC have been doing to stock investors. Reliance Industries has been doing good in the past 2-3 years, but before that it was a completely dead stock for 7-8 years. So overall, it has not given you much returns. It's just about 5x returns in 4 years. Comparatively, it's low. And then I have chosen 3 stocks which have completely died down. Reliance Capital, completely washed off. Jet Airways, completely washed off. Yes Bank, almost washed off. Okay. If your portfolio comprised of all of these names, at that point in time, you did not know that one company would be such a big multi-bagger and that one company would die down. So this is the scenario that always happens with investors. Whenever you create a portfolio, you will never know what the future holds for you. But you try to diversify your portfolio in such a way that more or less the trusted names are also there and a couple of risky names are also there, so that you are balanced in both ways. Mukul, if you can move to the next slide. Now, if I had invested equal amount in all of these companies, let's say I started off with a capital of 1 lakh in 2009. If you look at the blue line, which shows my returns, I had started off with 1 lakh rupees in 2009 and invested 10,000 rupees in each of the names. And I had held on to each of the names till 2019 end. 1 lakh would have become close to 64 lakhs. That is unmatchable returns. That's a 50% CAGR. That's the kind of power compounding has. Vaibhav had explained in one of the earlier sessions the power of compounding. If you look at the graph, it is gradually moving up, but then the power of compounding takes shape. If you look at this same graph for another 10 years, it will be even steeper, because compounding is acting in favor of us. Okay. But now somebody would ask you this question. Back in 2009, when I was constructing my portfolio, okay, I did not know that Bajaj Finance would be such an outperformer, or Asian Paints, or Jet Airways, or you know, any stock would be as good as what Reliance is. Reliance was a big name back then. Reliance is a big name right now. Tata Motors was big then. ITC was in the flavor then. So why would I have invested so much money in Bajaj Finance? It's impractical. I would not have done that, right? I give you 100 points. Even today, when you construct your portfolio, you should not have smaller names having equal weightage to larger names. Smaller names should always have a weaker weightage. So let's move on to the next slide. I have constructed a scenario in which I have given greater weightage to the bad names. Mukul, the next slide, please. Now, this is the scenario 2, which is the most practical scenario that everyone would have. Sorry. Somebody wants to say something? Okay. Sorry, in case I'm missing out on some of the questions, I'll take it up later. Most of them, Vaibhav and Rahul are already answering. Had I invested my 1 lakh rupees of capital in markets in the manner that is, you know, shown in the below slide, suppose I had taken a risk and I invested 50% of my capital in bad stocks like Yes Bank, Jet Airways, Reliance Capital. Okay? I'm creating one of the worst scenarios that is possible. And 30% of the remaining of the 30% capital in the underperformance, which have hardly given me much any return, Tata Motors, Reliance, and ITC. Only 10% each in Maruti, Bajaj Auto, Bajaj Finance, and Asian Paints. I mean, that is a fair kind of a portfolio distribution one can expect to have, right? Of large cap, mid cap, and small caps. Even in that scenario, 1 lakh rupee invested in 2009 would have grown close to 33-34 lakhs in 10 years. Even that is a 40% CAGR, guys. Not a joke. Not a joke. Right? Hardly anyone can learn this. This is a one-time investment in 2009, not an SIP format. I did this similar exercise in an SIP format. The returns were also good. In the second case, when I am giving greater weightage to the bad names, the returns were close to 12x when I did an SIP, because I was investing at higher prices also. Okay. And I took another scenario. If you know, you had invested only for 5 years, at a time in Bajaj. Mukul, if you can go to the slide before this. Now, if I had invested in 2015, let's say, with Bajaj Finance already at 403, so significant amount of uprise has already been gone. Yes Bank at 161, which means a huge amount of fall is pending. And every stock has risen. So my overall percentage returns would have fallen down. If I am asking even for a 5-year period of holding, even then my returns would have been more than 10x. Okay. So 2-3 lessons that we derive out of this exercise is, Mukul, if you can go to the next slide. One is, do not put all your eggs in one basket. Okay. Portfolio diversification is important. However sure you were that Jet Airways is going to do good in 2009, you should not have put all your money there. Similarly, however sure you were about Bajaj Finance or Asian Paints, you should not have put all your money in that company. It is risky. The end result might have been anything, but the process is risky and you would have lost your sleep. Similarly, there is no point in having an elephant in the room which cannot even move a tree. Had I invested only 1% of my portfolio in Bajaj Finance, probably it wouldn't have given me any benefit as compared to the others. So although I'm saying do not put all eggs in one basket, but at least give some weightage, 3-4% weightage at least to each stock in the portfolio. I have some friends who have invested in portfolio of 50 stocks, 60 stocks. I mean, that is not going to help you at any point in time. 30 stocks will be up, 30 stocks will be down. Your portfolio will not give you gains. Other points, please don't marry a stock. If you look at the price of Reliance Capital, it had started falling. I personally had invested in Reliance Capital at a price of 623 rupees per share in 2011. It kept falling after that. That was probably my first investment in markets directly in my own account. It kept falling. My father told me just one thing. If you made an investment and if you feel your investment is going wrong, if you feel something materially has changed in the stock, don't take it upon your ego. You have not married to the stock. You can sell it. So I sold it off at 403. Today the price is only about 3 rupees. Right? So if you make a mistake, sell it. And definitely not keep investing and averaging in the same stock. And again, as my father said, if you believe that you have actually found a gem, please hold on to it as long as you hold on to managers. Okay, as long as you believe in the story. Mukul, next slide, please. So I'll just, before we move on to the next topic, I'll just see in case we have missed out any question. Okay, in the interest of time, I think Vaibhav is answering most of the questions. In case some question is left at the end of the session, then we can take it up again towards the end. Now that we have looked at the question of portfolio diversification, the importance of portfolio diversification, how to construct a portfolio. Now let us go granular and ask the $1 million question. How do you actually select a stock? Mukul, next slide, please. How do we actually select each of those 10 stocks in the portfolio? So again, just to explain this to a layman without going into technical details, I have tried to bring up an analogy of a job with stock selection. We do a lot of analysis in picking up in selecting which company to work for. We should invest similar amount of energy in selecting which stock to invest in. And the factors that you look up in both the cases are the same. What factors would you look up in an employer or a company before you join a new job? Let's try to answer those. Mukul, the next slide, please. And why am I comparing a job with investing is because job gives you the salary, right? Investing gives you the extra money. So both are sources of creating wealth. So none of them is less important than the other. Now, selecting a stock is based on how you would have gone forward to select a job. Now, there are two kinds of jobs that people look up to. One is, I want to take up a job right now and I want to hold on to that job and I want to retire from there. So that's a long-term investment. Okay. Then there are certain people who say, I just want to get rid of my current company right now. Or maybe I want to have a stint in a particular role for a year or two and then I'll quickly move ahead. Depending on what your psychology or what your objective behind the job selection is or behind that particular company selection is, your, you know, judging factors or your, you know, criteria would be dependent on that particular objective. So if my objective is to make quick money from a particular job or to get an additional CV point or just to find a temporary exit from the current job, what are the things that I should take care of while looking for a job? A company which offers me a good opportunity, which means good money in the short term. The stock market analogy of the same would be a company which offers me good amount of, you know, money in the short term. Somebody has told me that I'll get good money if I invest in a particular XYZ company in the next 1 to 2 years. I'm sure you would still do a lot of research on that particular job and you will go with that job only when you are sure. Okay. However, tell me one thing. Will this risk run in your mind that even if I am opting for a job temporarily, what if, because of some reasons, internal or external, etc., I am not able to actually find a new job? Probably my CV has become too technical, or, you know, the external market is not good. It's a coronavirus situation. If I'm unable to find a job, I'm held up with my existing job only, a job which I actually did not want to hold for a long period. In such kind of a scenario, will you resign from the job and sit at home? No, you will carry for it, right? So even if you are looking for a short-term assignment in a job, you should look for that assignment in a company in which you would have been comfortable to remain till retirement. What I mean is, if I want to take up a job in Maruti today, I want to have a short-term assignment in an automobile company. Instead of going for some of the new names that might have been coming up, I should rather go or opt for that in Maruti, because even if I'm unable to exit from Maruti for some particular reason, or if I fall ill or whatever happens, my money is stuck there, I am stuck there, and I know the company is also there for the long term. So even when you want to do a short-term trade, although it is not a suggested trade, but even if you want to do a short-term trade, do it only in the stocks in which you are confident about in the long run. Don't do it in small names. Just because a broker, you know, texted you that the prices would go up, or you read it in Money Control, or you read it anywhere, stocks for the next year. Often we find it in, you know, experts coming up on Money Control at the time of Diwali, stocks for the next Samvat. I mean, a 12-month horizon is a very small horizon for stock picking. So let's avoid that. Okay. So if I am to, if you know, I'll just rush about a bit. The lesson that we learn from here is, if you lose out on an opportunity, because either you believe you are not ready for that opportunity or you believe that opportunity is not the best one, doesn't matter. If you lose an opportunity, the next one will come up. But if you lose your capital by investing in that opportunity, that capital can never be replaced. Right? So don't lose money. Next slide. Nikhil, please. Mukul?
Yashwant, are you on the right slide?
Yeah, on the right side. So what are the critical factors that you would choose when you, you know, you go for when you choose a job? Okay. Again, the objective is long-term in mind. The 10-year holding period that I showed to you, which you can probably even extend further, that should be the objective behind it. So the best job hunt is when, first of all, you need to think about which industry you want to work for, or which industry you want to select the stock in. Industry view is always the first step in picking, in stock picking. Why? Because if you invest in a particular industry which you believe may or may not exist after 5 years,
what's the point of taking that industry? Pick another. Its industry existence is first, is the first thing. After that comes this stock stability. If you believe your company to be in existence even after 10 to 15 years, only then you invest in that particular company. Only then you join that particular company. So I'm looking at stability, one, when I look for a job. Second is I look at growth. There's no point in getting a stable job if I'm earning only 1% or 2% increment every year. This, so mere existence is not enough. I need a good growth too. Do you see a good growth in a company's market share or in a company's profits year after year? If you see yes, then it's a good point. So then it's, you know, that particular criteria is fulfilled. And the last and the most important thing is management quality. Everything else can go for a toss.
Oh, sorry, Amit. Is it okay now? Yeah. So we have spoken about industry, stability and growth as three important figures, you know, I would want to invest in. I would like to look at before investing. I need an industry which is going to be in existence after so many years. I want a job which is stable. And I want a job which will give me a good growth year after year. And I would also want a good management. A good boss can make or break things. Okay. And the boss, when you are investing in a stock market, the boss is the management of the particular company. We need to analyze and judge a good company. Otherwise, whatever happens, you will fail in your investment. And this is the most difficult and the most interesting part of stock analysis. Mukul, if you can move to the next slide. Rahul will now take up for actually helping you analyze how to pick a good stock. What are the key factors that you should look for in picking a stock? The analogy with job will help you in relating it to the factors that he'll be speaking up. Mukul, can you move to the next slide? Okay, Rahul?
Yes. Yeah. Hello, guys. Everyone. So
see, there are a couple of...
Sorry, I can hear you.
Yeah, I'll just go on mute, Rahul, 1 second.
All good? Yeah, I think it's better now. Yeah. So guys, there are probably 100,000 different ways of analyzing a particular stock. Some of them and some of the don'ts have been clearly laid out by Yashwant. What I wanted to impart to you right now is that all of us are right now here assembled and discussing on personal finance. And for personal finance, as Yashwant and Vaibhav have repeatedly pointed out, it's like a discipline game for a very, very long time, where you want to stay invested, you want to stay in the game for as much as possible. So just as Vaibhav said, more of a test rather than a one day or a T20. That's a separate discussion. If people are interested in trading or if people are interested in short-term kind of investment and all, but let's now right now keep our entire discussion to how do you do, as people call it, value investing or investing in stocks that stay with you for a reasonable amount of time. Once your goals are achieved, and then you can make an exit about it. So amidst all of that, it's always whenever you're now, some of you might be very, very new to equity, pure equity investing. So I'll just start from there, that it is very necessary that you have a theme in mind whenever you are getting into an equity market. This could be any theme, like to put it in very plain and simple words, before you start doing a little bit of analysis about what you want to buy, you would want to know ki at least what industry does the company belong to, what is the core of the industry, and is the industry doing well? Ultimately, no matter if it is Rakesh Jhunjhunwala or Radha Kishan Damani or any, or like your close friend who gives you stock tips and all, it is going to be your judgment and call at the end of the day. That is very, very important. You might have a certain take on an industry. The economists of the world might have a certain take on the industry. But if, as far as the industry metrics kind of satisfy your set of checklists, that, you know, I think, so every industry has a value chain, right? Like somebody is buying some sort of raw materials and then making the thing and then distributing it, and then the customer a certain demands about it, and then the company does appropriate level of marketing, customer buys it, and then there is this whole process of paisa mila. I mean, if they got the money or not, at what time are they getting the money and all of that. So those are the tons and tons of ratios that people talk about, that this should be between this and this, this should be between that and that. To analyze that, let me just take a very simple example. Am I able to share my screen? Yeah, I'm able to share my screen. So again, guys, I am not propagating any particular website or something. It's just I find certain websites pretty easy to kind of show a lot of things. So I'll just give you a demo. So this is this website is called StockEdge. I've been using it a lot lately just because I like the look and feel of it, and it has quite quite exhaustive set of data. You guys can feel free to choose a lot of other websites also, which are equally good, if not better. So basically, one fine day you wake up and you want to say and want to start investing in equities. You go to, and of course, guys, as Vaibhav said, ET or some sort of a newspaper which kind of gives you an idea about the financial markets would be a good start point, according to us. So once you're zeroed in on a particular sector, let's say, you know, Abhi, like Devesh or somebody was saying that pharma is very good and all of that. So just I'll help you understand how do you maneuver around and do stuff before you kind of start doing the fundamental analysis. What fundamental analysis basically means is how strong the company is in terms of the operations that it is doing. Whatever work it is doing, whether it is doing it efficiently or not, whether it is producing at a cost effective rate, whether it is selling at an appropriate price, whether it is able to retrieve that savings or not, and whether it is buying appropriate assets to kind of expand and get into newer markets. That's all your balance sheet, profit and loss and cash flow. Bas utna hi dekhna hota hai basically, fundamental analysis mein. So sorry if I'm using a couple of Hindi words, guys, habit. So like this is a StockEdge page. So say if you go to the sectors section here, you will get a very nicely and neatly arranged set of sectors, abrasives, agriculture, alcohol, automobiles, and all like tons and tons of different sectors you have here. So, I mean, once you have decided, agar aapko ye bhi nahi malum hai ki sectors kitne saare hain, you can take a look at this list and then probably go about doing a little bit of research ki how is the agriculture sector doing. There are tons and tons of industry reports also. We don't want you to go like, and I mean, we don't restrict you either, but we don't want you to like read 200 pages of data and analyze something. But even if you read like a couple of articles, you'll be able to understand something about the sector, that you know sector ka value chain kya hai basically, matlab saman aata kahan se and ultimately where does it finally go, like where are you buying your stuff from, where are you making and where are you selling, and what is your market and how is the market doing, is your stuff good enough. So just take any example. Yashwant, Vaibhav, give me a name of a stock that I can show. Anything would work.
Take up Maruti.
Cool. All right. Passenger cars. See, there are only three in India. So, yeah. So, if you go to a particular sector, you will get all the stocks here, which are currently listed. I think StockEdge right now has the whole depository. So, yeah. These are some of the stocks which are there in the automotive sector. Now, right now you might be reading a lot about how automotive is not doing really well. So the moment you want to start thinking about this particular sector, now that is when that whole papers and articles and everything come into mind. So it's basically a typical manufacturing sector. You buy raw materials, you make the cars, you assemble it, and then you distribute it through dealers and through the retail chain. So that is the whole thing. Now, automobile sector is not doing very well because a lot of parts are made in China and they're imported here. So there is this whole supply chain which is kind of in a fix. And automotives usually have a cycle when they are in boom and then when they are again in bust. And usually they're kind of aligned to our economy also, because the moment you have money, like more disposable income, and the economy is doing well, you will want to buy a car, right? So try to keep it very simple, like very common sense and logical. Will this work right now in the next year or so? do you think people will have a lot of disposable income at hand to buy a lot of cars and all? So again, that analysis is up to you. So once you open any particular stock's ticker, which we call it, you'll usually the first thing that will hit you, even if it's Money Control or if it's Stockage or any other app, is going to be the price chart. I think it's a good start to take a view at what the price chart is telling you. Don't go for a day, week, month or so. Go at least for a year. See how the price chart has kind of moved along the way. Go for a two-year view also. Go for a five-year view also. Just see how the company has been doing over a period of time. The kind of bars below, this is the volume basically. So just to give you a basic understanding, it tells you how much volume got traded during the particular day or during the particular month, how the chart is constructed. So if you see for Maruti, it started off at 4,005 years ago, and it's I think went through a couple of cycles of ups and downs here and here and again here right now because of the pandemic. And but it has been doing fairly decently. It's closing in to what it was 5 years ago. So a lot of people might treat this as an opportunity as well, that, you know, it's a cyclical kind of a stock like most of the auto sector stocks are. If you look at deliveries, so Stockage also kind of gives you a lot of information as to what does it mean, what is the importance of deliveries, whether there has only been a lot of trade on futures and options or whether people have actually bought it and taken home the stock. So these give you the charts of deliveries, that what the deliveries are and how have they been and what has been the percentage change. This again, you can get it elsewhere as well. Again, updates gives you a ton of news around Maruti Suzuki, the automotive sector and the industry that it is related in. And I think a lot of us kind of, whenever there is a price increase or a decrease or a sudden jump and all, we usually come down to the update section to see what the news around the sector and the company has been. Then there is, again, there are a lot of subsections within it. I think we don't have enough time to go through each and every section. And then there are technicals. So again, if you see right now, automotive sector, not the best of the sectors probably. So this basically tells you, so say for example, if you hold the stock, like purchase the stock 1 year back, you are 30% almost down on the stock. But if you had purchased it 5 years ago, you're probably around 44% in the upside. And this again, I think 44% on the base of that 5 years. So these are some of the technical indicators. Basically stock, what is the buzz around the stock? What the stock has been doing. So you'll get a fair idea that, okay, the prices have been at a certain level. There have been a delivery. So these are mostly for people who do trading and do short-term kind of investing, more applicable to them. And then you come down to the fundamental part, basically. So Stockage also gives you a profile about what the company does, what sector industry it is kind of engaged in, what is the market capital, earnings per share, trailing for 12 months. This is basically the last four quarters, may how this stock has performed. Our very favorite ratio, which is the PE ratio. Again, as Yashwant pointed out, very essential to kind of track it with your peers and the industry. So Maruti being, I think, the front runner of this industry is very close, and it is practically the industry in the passenger vehicle segment with almost, I think, 60-odd% of market share. It's very close to the industry P. And then there are other kind of ratios as well. Now, unfortunately, this being a two-hour course, we would have loved to, but we cannot delve into ratios and all. Yashwant, we would have loved to do this, right? But these are some of the ratios that kind of pop up during the investment decision-making stuff. However, I think what will be more important is if we go into financials. So guys, the best, I mean, until and unless you're working for a wealth management company or like Webhub is, or if you're really, really into a stock broking company where you kind of make analyst reports and all of that, and you have like a close understanding with the company, I think the public data is all that you have. And the best, and if you want to invest in the company for a long period of time, the best way to start doing that is A, doing your primary research, and then probably going and reading the annual report of a company. If you go to any company's website and the investor relations wala part, you will find that they have filed their annual reports there. Now, what does this annual report say? Basically, what did we do in the last year? And what are we proposing to do probably in the next couple of or 5 year horizon? These are really fancy looking. For some of the companies, these are really, really fancy looking reports. Again, these are very huge. You don't need to read through the entire section. Try reading the initial 5-7 pages because it tells you what ITC does. So say, for example, this is an ITC ka. I hope you can see my screen. Yashwant, my screen is visible, right? Or am I talking to myself?
Yeah. It's visible.
Sorry. Yeah. So this is like ITC's annual report. It will tell you that, you know, I am into, if you thought that ITC was only FMCG and tobacco, no, there might be other segments also. So they are into hotels, of course. And they are also, they have an agri arm, they have an IT arm. So these are the segments that they are involved in. And then you can probably come more closer to making that decision that, you know, this much percentage of ITC is FMCG, this much is hotels, this much is paperboard packaging, information, agribusiness. So you'll, by the first 5 to 7 pages where you have like a lot of information given, you'll have slightly better understanding than anybody else that what does ITC do and what it has been doing in the last year. In the annual report, I would specifically ask you to look at 2 or 3 sections which are very, very important. One of them is segment reporting. Segment report. Yeah. So segment report is basically a section of the financial statements where a company has to kind of break down its entire business into certain categories. That I am FMCG, okay, but FMCG cigarettes is this much of my entire, this is the revenue also. So of my entire revenue, this is my revenue coming from cigarette. This is my revenue coming from others, hotels, agribusiness and all. So you'll know ki if I think that agribusiness and cigarettes is going to do well, and if that constitutes say around 60-70% of the entire business, then probably ITC is a good kind of a stock for me. It also has your profits from respective segments and all of that. So yeah, it's an interesting part of the annual report. Similarly, there would be a couple of other parts, some other sections as well, which is your promoter holdings and related party and related disclosure. So basically, how much is the company doing, how much business is the company doing with related parties and all of that. Plus, you would also have certain things called as contingent liabilities. Basically, these are those liabilities jo abhi tak liability nahi hai, but they can become liabilities in future. So say, for example, if you give a guarantee of a loan taken by a friend, so it is a contingent liability for you, because if your friend kind of defaults the loan, then the bank is going to come and collect it from you. So there are a lot of other contingent liabilities also. So especially if you are planning to invest in banks and all, and investing in financial services and all of that, they have a separate way of showing their balance sheet. But you, and also for companies which, you know, have a lot of subsidiaries, you might want to take a look at that section as well. Okay, I will kind of switch now from this to something else. So always have a look at the financial reports, annual report especially, and they also have to do quarterly filings also. So take a look at that. And there are sometimes they give you investor presentations also that, you know, this is like a 10-page PPT with the main facts, jo ki humko batana tha, jo hum usually 345-page ke annual report mein batate. So just look at these facts and then you can kind of start moving even deeper. I'll just quickly go back to the financials wala part. Isme advice, try looking at the P&L first of all. What the net sales have been, have they been on a rise year on year? In case of ITC, in case of Maruti, they have been. Also then come down and look at the profit after tax or profit before interest, depreciation and tax, Jobi. Whether this has also been on the rise. You can then switch to cash flow. And cash flow, mein, I would suggest avoid everything else. And this is again, because we have paucity of time. and look at cash flow from operations. So basically, three different sources of cash. This is the most important because this is dhande wala cash. So just check ki from operations how much cash is coming in and whether that has been on the rise or not. ITC might have invested in a lot of its subsidiaries and or probably bought shares, which it's not allowed to do. But it must have invested in certain other assets. There might be certain companies jinke rental income hi unke operations ke income se bahut zyada hote hain. So just take a look at cash from operations and whether that is increasing or not. And then finally, you can take a look at the balance sheet. In times like these, in times like coronavirus and all, people usually tend to like companies that don't have a lot of debt. So you will find that in non-current liabilities wale section mein, as in the case of ITC, it's blank, which is amazing. So whatever sector you're interested in, whatever company you're interested in, this is some of the very basic analysis that you would want to do. And you'd always want to keep the external environment in your background, that what is going on around, going around right now. Will the business be as pacey, as growing as it had been in the last couple of years or quarters? Or what is the change in outlook? A little bit of reading on the paper, a little bit of annual reports, a little bit of financial analysis. And I think if you combine all of this, you'll be able to arrive at a good kind of a judgment that, you know, whether this company is good or not, whether the future prospects look good or not. All right, Yashwant, I would just want to take a pause here for a second and ask you and Vaibhav that do we have like 5 more minutes of time? Should I kind of go ahead and show people how do this NSC and BSC's website and that market depth look like? All right. So since market is not in function right now, guys, agar aap nscindia.com pe, if you guys go and you go to and you type any company's name here, and I like Cipla is like the in thing right now, producing lots and lots of medicines for everybody. So if you type Cipla here, you'll and you click on Cipla, you'll come to this page, and this will give you a lot of information that, you know, what is the last traded price here? What did the market open at? What was the highest that the market went? What was the lowest that the market went? And then what did the market finally close at? There are some post-close activities also, and hence the difference a little bit. And this, again, will give you a lot of company information and all of that. So this small box that you see here, it's usually filled, and it gives you a clear picture as to what is the total number of people, like what is the buy quantity at a particular point of time in the live market scenario, and what is the sell quantity. Now, some of the common myths are ki usually agar buy quantity is more than the sell quantity, then more people are wanting to buy it. So let's buy this stock. Don't do that. That's like not necessary that the stock is always going to move towards the greener pastures if the buyers are more than the sellers, because these are not executed trades. So what I mean when I say this is that you may have put that I want to buy Cipla at 585. Okay. And you have put that order in your DMAT account and then you have gone off to sleep. So that account, that order is right now somewhere here in the buy side as unexecuted. And similarly for sellers also, they might have put like, I want to sell Cipla at 597. So that must be here. So it's not a very accurate indication that, you know, there is more kind of a bull intention here or more kind of a bear intention if the numbers change. So keep that in mind. It just shows that there are a lot of people who are intending to buy it, probably not the trade at the price at which it's trading. And there are a lot of people who are willing to sell, but at a different price than what it is trading. Okay. FIIs or wo bhi ho sakte hain yahan pe, but unke alag desks, they have like separate desk and they don't usually wait in the queue to get the stocks. They get it they have break down their entire demand and then they get it. So like, let's not go in there. And similarly for BSC also, again, a very blue website, and it also has a lot of information similar. Most of the ratios that you're going to find are going to be very, very similar. So this is the market depth for that as well. So similarly, just type in any stock's name and you'll get all of these details, like Reliance here, Okay, so again, I'm taking a pause here. I have told you about annual reports. I have told you about ITC. I'll just take 1 minute and touch upon Screener as well. So guys, this is a very cool website where, and for all the engineers out there, they'll like it. This has a lot of query and all of that. So this is a website which shows you different screens, basically. Like, if you go to the screen section of this particular website, it already has some screens which it has built. Screens ka matlab basically filter hai in this case. So they have applied certain filters, and if you click on a particular filter here, so say for example, undervalued growth stock, which has a gram number, and so there might be a lot of jargons here, gram number, and you know, PEG ratio, this, that, or say for example, bluest of the blue chip, like large caps with market cap of greater than 3000, blah, 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 blah. If you click on that, it'll give you a list of all the stocks. And if you kind of register and log in, what you can do is you can build your own screen as well. Like you can keep on typing ki mujhe aisa company chahiye jiska market cap 500 se less ho, price to earning less than 15, but no debt and all of that. And then you can run the query and it can give you a list. So just a way to zero in on the stock, the sector, wherever you want to play. So that was like a very brief about fundamental analysis. I would leave the mic here. It's already 10:20, guys. We became quite passionate. So yeah, I'll just stop sharing right now. Sorry. Yeah.
Thanks, Rahul, for covering fundamental analysis. And he has touched upon every single point that you need to look at. Okay. Although in the paucity of time, we could cover it only in 20 minutes. But as we said repeatedly, it's not a course of equity analysis. Hence, we have just touched upon everything that you might need to know, in a sketchy little bit.
Sorry, Yashwant, I think we lost you.
Is it audible right now?
Yeah, now it is. Now it is.
So, Rahul has covered almost everything that needs to be covered in financial analysis. Before we quickly move on to mutual funds, Mukul, if you can just put up the PPT again once. So, everything that Rahul has covered till now, okay, the most important things that people had been asking in the previous sessions as well, about PE ratio. So there are common fundamental myths about P ratio. People say the lower the P ratio, the better it is. Buy a company with a low P ratio, sell a company that has a high P ratio. Trust me, those things used to apply a lot in earlier markets when a lot of information was not available publicly. But with the amount of analysis and the amount of coverage that each company has currently, these ratios need to be looked at in a different way. For instance, the PE ratio of a company needs to be looked at in association with PE ratio of other companies in the same sector. Different sectors will have different averages of PE ratio. For instance, FMCG companies always valued higher. Okay, because of multiple reasons, its PE ratio is generally above 30, 35, 40, 45 in some cases. Okay, whereas a steel company or a power company or any PSU company for that matter will have a PE ratio lower than 10. Right, so you cannot compare HUL with JSW Steel. It's a wrong comparison if you're doing a PEK ratio comparison. However, you should compare HUL with PNG and JSW Steel with Tata Steel. Right, second thing is within the same sector, a PE ratio, a company with a higher PE ratio is overvalued and a company with a lower PE ratio is undervalued. This also is a myth. I'll give an example of Asian Paints. Asian Paints has been consistently valued at a PE ratio of more than 50, at a high of 65 at times, consistently over the years, but it has not fallen. Why so? Because it has also delivered that kind of growth. A high PE ratio with a high growth or a high growing company will continue to enjoy the kind of premium. A high PE ratio means the market is offering you a premium, and a company which has been enjoying premium in the past may continue to enjoy premium. I'm not saying it will, it may. So similarly, there are companies, Mukul, if you can move to the slide after this, yeah, I'll just take another one.
So just as we move, so as Yashwant was saying that HUL has a PE ratio of somewhere upwards of 75, and it might still be cheaper compared to some of its peers like Nestle, which have a PV of 80 and above. So again, as he mentioned, not the only factor that you should consider.
Yeah, no. And so we have covered two things. P ratio needs to be looked at with the industry, and also in line with what the company had a P ratio of in the past. I mean, for all ratio analysis and all financial analysis, you need to look at what was the past trend of the same and that other companies in the same sector have been having. Okay? And for every sector, the valuation metric is not P ratio. P ratio cannot be the evaluation metric for a banking industry. For banking industry, the most common valuation metric is price by book value. Similarly, for industries, for the steel industry, it's EBITDA per ton. Okay? For telecom industry, it's the average revenue per user, the ARPU that we commonly call. Whenever you start analyzing a particular company, since we mentioned, you know, industry analysis comes first. So pick up a couple of industry reports, read them, go to the annual report and look up all the sections that Rahul mentioned and try to read the particular section on management discussion and analysis, where they talk about how the industry is actually going. Mukul, can you move to the next slide? Okay. And the last, I think this is not covered. Anyways. Buying a stock is just half of the work done. You do not make money till the time you sell stocks. So it is also important to sell stocks. While a long-term holding is good, but even for stocks that you initially intend for long-term holding, you need to sell it at some point in time. When do you sell it? Either of the three scenarios. When your target is achieved, then you sell off the stock, or when there is a material change in the company's story. I invested in Yes Bank with a particular story in mind. You know that the company is doing good. And, you know, the growth is nice. However, the day I realize that there is something fishy about the company, I exit because my story no longer remains valid. And the third important point is, and I would like to link it with the first session that we had, you should sell at a reasonable time before a personal goal falls due. For instance, if you need money 1 year down the line, you should probably start selling right now, and you should complete selling stocks within 6 months. Although you have been holding that particular name for 5 years or 7 years, if you need money after 1 year, do not wait for the 11th month to sell stocks. A coronavirus situation might just come up. Mukul, the next slide, please. And so
sorry, just give me a minute, Yashwant. I was sharing the screen. Just give me a sec.
Doesn't matter.
Yeah, I think Mukul is back. Yeah.
Yeah. So, Suman, your question: any source where you can do industry analysis? Well, the best source is Google. Okay, Google up and read about as many reports as you can. So, we are not advocating that any report might be completely correct or wrong. At the same time, there'll be something to learn from each of the reports. A new term that you get it, Google it up and try to build your own understanding of the report. Always understand that for any particular company or for any particular industry at any point in time, you will get a buy report and you will also get a sell report. None of them are right. Okay, they are only right in hindsight. So you need to take the best of all of those things. Last slide, actually.
Are we on the right track? Right slide?
So I will end equities with last of the three lessons that I wanted to share with you. And these are some of the words said by some of the biggest investors in the country. People generally go for timing the market, timing the highs and timing the lows. It's not important. What is important is the time that you actually spend in the market. If you stay for a long period of time, as we looked in that example of 10 stocks, you will make money. If you try to time the market every time, you know, when it's going, first of all, you cannot do that. Second of all, you will end up making losses. And again, if you do short-term trading, you should do that with money, with that particular money which you are able to, you know, keep aside for the next 4-5 years. In case I bought a very good company like HDFC at 1200, however coronavirus came up, I wanted that money back in 2 months. Stock like HDFC, which might go to 2500 3 years down the line, but I'll have to sell it at 850 rupees because the amount of money that I invested was not my surplus money. So don't do that mistake. And the last thing is, stock picking is not a process of selection. It is a process of elimination. This was said by Mr. Ramdev Agarwal of Motilal Oswal. There are 3,000 stocks listed in the market. Okay, 3,000 plus. If you keep on buying stocks, particular insider news that you find, you might have to select 2,000 companies out of that. But you cannot do that practically. So instead of finding out one good reason to invest in a particular stock, try to find out that one bad reason not to invest in that stock. And then invest in those companies in which you have least amount of bad reasons. The chances of you making loss will be much lower. And the last question, where everyone is asking and people says overall market is high. See, the overall market is high is said when people look at the historical use metric. Okay, although it is not a metric that can be applied to all sectors, but when we look at the overall index as the Nifty or the Sensex, all companies in that have a particular earnings profitability. You know, you are willing to sell 20 rupees to buy stocks. Okay, the average P ratio of Nifty in the past has been 16 roughly. So when the P of Nifty goes above 16, people say the market has started becoming expensive.
Yashwant, I think your voice is breaking a little.
Becoming expensive. Then people say the market has started becoming cheap. Abhi, is it okay?
It's slightly better.
The last point was audible, Rahul, the last point that I said.
Can you repeat one's last?
Yeah, it would be great if you could repeat.
So again, I'll just repeat the last point that I said. Yeah. So we have a particular P ratio for Nifty, which is 60. Historical average of Nifty's P ratio, Nifty P ratio. But we believe that overall, when the P ratio of Nifty increases above 16, the market is becoming cheaper. So currently, if you look at current scenario, the P ratio of market before the coronavirus crisis came in, and P ratio can be calculated in multiple manners. I'm only talking about the one. There is a trailing P ratio, last P ratio. So in most of the reports that you would have read, it's about the forward P ratio of FY20 estimates. So Nifty was trading about 20-21 times. It's closing on to 16.5 times right now. It is closing on to the overall average. Okay, so some people say that it will bounce back from this average. Others say it will first fall below this average. Then only time will tell who is right. But that is how people overall take a view of whether the market is highly valued or not.
I think we have totally lost you now, Yashwant. Yeah.
Well, I was just reading. The best practices of the at least I follow. So I don't follow any particular person. There are 7-8 videos I regularly watch, reviews I regularly watch. The 15-20 lessons that I, shared. In the class today, are the lessons taken from their interviews only?
Yashwant, I think, can you try rejoining the call once? In the meantime, Vaibhav, would you like to take it? I think we are losing Yashwant.
Sure, Rahul, I can take, but I think it's already 10:32. I just wanted to cover mutual fund section today.
Okay.
Because I think this is one of the most important session for
So guys, for the open group, are we okay if we extend it by 15 minutes or so? You can type it on the chat box. Like,
I mean, if 5 or 7 people type in, we can get an answer.
Right. You guys can, yeah, okay.
Great. Okay, guys.
Awesome. Thanks. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Mukul, meanwhile, just go to the next slide and I can just... So guys, whatever has been spoken by Rahul and Yashwan today regarding how you select equities, what all you need to look at the markets, what all you need to look at the particular stocks. Let me be very clear. This generally, researching on a stock and holding it for long term, yeah, this is part and parcel of a lot of people's actually job and the profile, which probably... guys, please be on mute, whosoever is not there. I think you have to put that on mute now. So yeah, so this is actually a vast study. So as I told on the first day, I generally put in 40 to 45 hours if I need to pick up and select a stock, doing the complete research. Now, like Yash, Rahul showed you the ITC page where there were a lot of annual reports. So generally, if I want to do a research on any company in much detail, I would rather go back 5 years, 6 years and read all their annual reports. Along with the annual reports, their financial statements, what are their notes to account. So this entails a lot of, you know, what very detailed study. It's not very simple, like some people were asking in the questions that which sectors should, I can give you those answers. There's not much of a problem with that. I can probably, like I said, I cannot give you stock specific names. I can do that, but you know what happens. When you are not researching yourself, you are not convinced yourself to pick up that stock, I can give you the entry point because we are talking today. And my time horizon, let's say, is 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, whatever. If you also notice on the comment section, I had noticed exit strategy is very important. Today, if I tell you that, okay, pharma sector looks very good to me, and I tell you that, okay, these 3 or 4 stocks are very good based on my research or whatever. And now that you buy these shares tomorrow or maybe in the next month by staggering and all, but let's say 3 or 4 years down the line or 2 years down the line, when I think that it's time to exit, I don't remember whosoever in this class would have taken those stocks, right? Even if I am a good guy and I tell everybody who I have given a buy call to exit as well, I don't think so. It's practically possible for me to tell each and everybody that, okay, in that class, board infinity class, I told you to buy, now you can exit. Suman, that's fine. So that is what I am saying. So learning points wise, what I'm saying is that whatever Rahul and Yashwant have mentioned are the learning points. Right. Now, this is the start what you guys have been given. So in this class of 40 guys, there would be around 5-10 guys for sure who want to go further and do a little bit of research and a little bit of study. So let's start like this. As StockEdge website showed, there are a lot of number of sectors currently. First of all, you need to be particularly sure about which sectors you want to enter now. Today, if I can say, okay, pharma, FMCG, let's say even IT, I would think so, insurance sector is going to do good. There are many reasons why I think so. Let's not get into the reasons. So let's take these four sectors, and even the fifth sector, which I can include, is specialty chemicals. Now, in insurance sector, for example, the insurance sector, there is a listed company in life insurance as well. There is one listed company in general insurance. So general insurance is only ICICI Lombard. You don't have much option. But in life insurance, you have 4 companies, right? ICICI Life Insurance, HDFC, SBI, and Max Life. Now, which one you should pick up or pick on that? So that's the second level of study which you need to do. So ek bar sector, once you finalize the sector, then go into the individual companies. And again, as it has been covered, different sectors have different parameters how you can value those sectors. So insurance ke liye P by E ratio is not apt. A banking sector, NBFC, P by B ratio is not, P by E ratio is not apt. Unko price by book ratio pe you have to value them. So there are different telecom mein, you generally buying a telecom sector and by counting all these sectors, I forgot, I am very bullish on telecom sector as well. My reasons to buy a Vodafone or your Airtel, or the third is Jio. There are only 3 players and blah, blah, blah. So many reasons. I have always kept writing on them on my LinkedIn and website, the reasons why I'm bullish on that. But this is how the first level is done. And this is how you go into the second level when you go in the company. So like Rahul showed you on StockEdge in the auto sector, you had three stocks in the passenger vehicle segment. Although these three stocks were not great comparables, only Maruti Suzuki is there in the passenger vehicle, but then there are other sectors like, let's say, bank. So for example, again, my particular view, banking sector might not do that great. NBFC might be still worse now in the next coming probably 1 or 2 years. That completes my analysis. My analysis is from Prashant Jain of HDFC or Sunil Singhani of Abacus and a lot of big guys also. I don't care what are these guys thinking. If I am good with my analysis, I'll stick to it. I'll do my own research. I'll do my own. I buy my own stock. Someone asked, what is the way to think that market is overvalued or undervalued? Rahul pointed out correctly, one of the ways is what is the Nifty or a Sensex P/E. When in 2018 January, when the market started falling from then after the budget announcement, I think Nifty P/E had already risen to 28-29. Now you have to compare P/E by the company's P/E by the sectors. What are the other companies, other peers in the sector P/E? But Nifty P/E, how will you compare? Nifty P/E always compare with their historical averages. On an average, Nifty P/E has been 19 to 20 to 21, which is considered to be okay valued. Currently, it's like 15 around, 14, 15, 16, which you would say is undervalued, but it can go further below. Nobody knows how low it can go, but it's currently undervalued. That is what I know. But how much undervalued, I don't know. The degree, I don't know. Undervalued, yes. Similarly, overvalued, if let's say my particular strategy would be whenever Nifty P/E goes about 26, 27, or even 25, above 25, I would think it overvalued. So this is how sometimes I would do my entry and exit strategies. Satyam Singh, it's difficult. I don't think so. Any website gives that, but I'm sure some blogs or somewhere it would be mentioned. I think that's a good point to cover. Probably even one of my LinkedIn posts, I'll cover this, some sectors, specific ratios probably on my website. Anyway, so coming back to the point, last point before getting into the mutual fund thing is I was saying sectors are very important to look at, and exit strategy and entry strategy. So generally, and this is very good point to keep in mind, guys, whosoever is interested in picking up direct stocks, always maintain two different portfolios. One is your core portfolio and one is your satellite portfolio. Core portfolio is something which you take for the very long term, like about 7 years, 10 years, 20 years. I can give one or two examples in both my portfolios. I would pick Reliance as my core portfolio stock. I still have it. I have it for past 6-7 years. I'll still keep on adding to that those positions, because I think Reliance will do good in the next 10-15 years. Depending upon whatsoever market currently is going on. Obviously, if the broader market falls, entire market falls, Reliance also will see a fall. But it won't be that I will be exiting it and then again rebuying it, because this is something which I believe in the long-term story. But let's say a pharma stock, which I was talking about, and someone was asking what is the exit strategy. So pharma currently, I would say I had not bought pharma like a month back. Why? Because first of all, I don't understand that sector. Another major point is, guys, you cannot understand all the sectors. There are so many brokerage houses. There are so many research analysts. Those are particular to a sector, right? You would have heard that this is an auto analyst. This is a banking sector analyst. Why? Because they just understand one or two, maximum three sectors. I cannot understand 100 sectors. There's so many moving parts. Pharma, I don't understand because I'm not from a bio background. Whenever I see a name of the medicine, I just lose it. So you have to depend upon a lot of research analyst reports. What are they talking about? Form your own views, right? But now that I'm saying that I am not comfortable with pharma, I was not at all into pharma sector stock till 1 month back. But gradually I've been reading about it after this COVID and all. I will buy it today because I know that their valuation is very, very low. Their PE ratio was low. And now when I know that, okay, this sector is going to do good, I will hold it for, let's say, a year, maybe 18 months. And then I will sell it off when I think that PE has risen so far or too far. So this is my satellite portfolio stock. So this is how you differentiate between the two. Never touch your core. Just keep it. Just keep on adding it. Maybe you just use that money for marrying off your children or just for their kids' education and all those things we were talking about in the first session. I am not reading the comments as of now because I'm just speaking. So I'll go through these later. There are some few of them. So now let's come on to the people who cannot do that kind of a research. Well, see, picking up stocks is an art and in science, and generally people get paid a lot for it. It's not easy for anybody to just understand and start doing it. That is why so many mutual funds and so many PMSs are currently going on, and people are paying them 2% and 3% or 1.5% kind of fees also. So let's concentrate on what we can do if we are not aware about all these things. So we go to the mutual fund. Now, what is a mutual fund? Obviously, it's run by experts who have large teams under them who are keep doing sector specific research. Then there is a fund manager who will take a call depending upon what research has been done by particular sectors. And that fund manager might have a knowledge of a lot of sectors, because obviously 10 years, 15 years experience, he had already been into the markets and all. So he might understand it a lot better than probably we do. Second benefit with all these mutual funds and all are that these are institutional investors. The institutional investors will obviously have more information. Knowledge, obviously, we discussed, but they would also have more information than all of us, because they keep on meeting the promoters. Every week, every month, they will go and meet Asian Paints, let's say managing director, and ask him, what are you thinking about your this quarter numbers and this and that. And these guys have first-hand information, and then they can use. Obviously, generally, they do not trade on any private information. But obviously, when you ask the right questions to the managing directors or the CEOs or the chairman, the kind of answers you receive, you can make up your mind. This comes by experience. So generally, I would think that these guys have a lot of first-hand information, and we should leave our money in the hands of them if we trust those fund managers properly. Hence, this is a mutual fund where you can just keep putting your money, and then they have a portfolio of 40, 50, 60 stocks. Diversification also happens. There are a lot of stringent SEBI regulations regarding mutual funds, where the SEBI has said that no sector would be exposed more than 25% of the total AUM. AUM is asset under management. No particular single company can have more than 10% of your total AUM. So all these actually makes it a little more diverted towards having more and more diversification in those stocks. So now what we can do is we can think that, okay, now we should, since we cannot pick up stocks ourselves, let's take mutual funds. Now let's go into mutual fund. If you see this chart, this kid is thinking which, how, when, why. So first of all, which mutual fund you should buy, why you should buy, I've already explained you, and I hope you are convinced about it. Which, I'll tell you how, okay, and when. Now there are types of categorization. If you see the table, equities and fixed income are the two broad categories of mutual funds. And then there is hybrid, which is a mix of equities and fixed income. I don't think so. There's anything more to explain into that. Hybrid will generally be either a debt hybrid or an equity hybrid. An equity hybrid which will have more of equities, less of debt, and the vice versa. Then there is another category. Then another categorization method called open-ended and closed-ended. Yesterday in the fixed income session, I explained you what is a closed-ended and open-ended. Open-ended, you can buy anytime, sell anytime. Closed ended will open only for a certain 1 week or a 2 week period, where the fund manager will ask for the money, and then there will be an exit after 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, depending upon whatever the lock-in period of that fund is. I am not a fan of closed ended fund at all, because it does not give me much flexibility to time what should I do. I mean, when should I exit, when should I not. So only go for open ended funds. Third categorization is direct and regular. Now what happens is that in regular, a lot of minds are working towards it, a lot of effort is going behind. So obviously there are commissions. You need to pay these guys. So generally the commission is broken into two parts. One is the AMC, the asset management company who is making all these calls, who is making your portfolio, right? So one money goes to them. The second part of the money goes to the distributors who are actually selling you the mutual funds, like brokerage houses. Probably Edelweiss is also, so I will generally go and I will act as a distributor if I am selling you, let's say, a Kotak mutual fund. So the commission called the expense ratio is divided into two parts. Ek hota hai fees for the AMC, and the second fees is for the distributor. So when it's a regular fund, this means that both the commissions are going into that fund. But if you think that I don't need a distributor, distributor will also act as an advisor. You will say, I don't need an advisor, I don't need a distributor. I am myself strong enough to select which kind of a fund I would want to buy. So only go for a direct fund. So expense ratio for a regular will be generally close to 1.5 to 1.8% around. And for a direct, it would be 1%. So you are saving around 0.8, 0.7% if you are going for the direct method. And if you compound that over a period of 15, 20 years, it's a lot bigger value. So that's the third. If you are a new person, new investor in mutual funds, start with regular. And probably after 2-3 years, when you get comfortable, move towards direct. The fourth categorization is growth and dividend. So this dividend, mutual funds have actually lost flavor after the recent budget announcement where the dividend are not taxed in the hands of investors only. Otherwise, dividends were very much favored because of the tax advantages. You regularly kind of used to get dividends. Someone was asking this question that at the age of 45, I would want to have dividends fulfilling my needs. So there are other methods as well, which we'll cover as to why, if not dividend, then how can you do that similar kind of an arrangement by yourself. So these are the debt riskier than regular. Nagappan, no, it's the same portfolio. Portfolio will be same. Nobody, no separate people are managing it. It's just the fees. It's just the fees which is going towards to the distributor. When you go, if you are a new investor and you go from, if you are logging into a Kotak, if you have a brokerage account with Kotak, a trading or demat account with Kotak or an ICICI Direct, that means that you are paying a distributor fees because you are going through them. But these new discount brokerages like Zerodha and Kovera and Grow and all those things, they have actually eliminated the regular fund completely. They are saying we don't need the distributor fees. We will somehow, we'll do our business, different business model. Zerodha Coin is only direct funds. If you don't want to pay extra to your these distributor guys, just go for an account with Zerodha or a Grow and buy your direct mutual funds. Or Paytm Money. Yeah. Now, as I told you, growth and dividend. So growth will continue, keep investing in those stocks. You are not going to get anything out of it as a regular dividend or something. But whenever you want to sell those funds, exit those funds, redeem those funds, you will get your money with either a capital gains or a capital loss. Right now, everything is capital loss only if you had invested for the last 4 or 5 years. Yes, regular is ease of investment, correct. Everything you will see at one place. For me, what I do is, because I understand all those things, I don't need an advisor or a distributor. But what I need to do is either I go to Zerodha or a Paytm Money or a Grow to buy all these things, or else if I do not have account, I go to individual websites. I go to KotakMF.com, I go to ICICIMF.com, HDFCMF.com and buy directly from there. The only thing is that I need to maintain an Excel at my end separately to just track my stocks. There are many startups which have come, which consolidate all these things at one place. You can go that way. But as I told in the first session, I'm an old school guy. Every month I sit down on a Saturday and maintain the entire stock portfolio for myself. You guys don't need to do it. Because it's my profession, it's my job, I am doing it. So that's the categorization part. Now let's go into kind of equities, fixed income, hybrid and solution. There are generally 4 kind of mutual funds which are there. Now these are all which you can see on the screen. I mean, there's no values here. I mean, see, if you have hired an advisor who can develop as a distributor, then probably you are better off. Otherwise, generally what happens is that, you can easily buy through Zero. I being an advisor, I will advise you guys to go and buy only direct, don't buy regular. Even if you are new, if you have an account with Zerodha or a Paytm Money, open account there and go and buy a direct stocks. They are just the middleman. That's okay. No, I am not, it's okay for me. I mean, my clientele is completely different from what we have over here. Now let's go into equities and fixed income. As I explained you, and obviously these guys have also done this, there's large cap, mid cap, small cap, and there are actually SEBI regulations as to a large cap will hold 80% stocks in their portfolio, which are large cap. Now, what are large cap, mid cap, small cap kind of stocks? Twice every year, when you actually rank the companies by free float market cap, what is a free float market cap? Market cap, you know. These guys explained you. Share price into your number of shares. Free float would be subtract that portion which is with the promoters, which is only tradable in the markets for retail, institution, all these guys. So if Reliance is 40% owned by Mukesh Ambani, for example, it's only 60% of its market cap will be called free float market cap. So when you rank all the stocks from 1 to 5,000 stocks are there on BSE or on complete Indian markets, the top 100 stocks will be called large cap. 101 to 250 will be called mid cap. And every stock above 250, rank 250 and below will be called small cap. So a large cap mutual fund will have 80% of the stocks from top 100. Mid cap has a kind of a flexibility where they can go around 65% mid cap and rest 35% in large and small cap. And small cap also 65% in small cap and rest 35 in mid and large cap. So now you should need to consider that how do you do your portfolio allocation by buying some kind of funds from large cap, mid cap and small cap. First, I'm only concentrating on the equity portion, right? Now I would suggest people that depending upon your risk profile, if you are like highly enterprising, highly risky, if you have a 20 year time horizon, you can go a little overweight on your mid cap and small cap mutual funds and a little lesser on your large cap. But ideally, my suggestion, a generic statement, not to be applied personally or specifically to any person, I would say go, even if it's is a little bit of a risky investor, 50% large cap or 50 to 55%, 30 to 35% can go into mid cap and 10 to 15% can go into small cap. So that's something where you can take a risk in the small cap. Secondly, there are other aspects also. There are a lot of strategies, a lot of things which can be made into this. Generally, some people also would want to buy an index fund rather than a large cap fund. Why? So let's say there is an index called Nifty 100. Obviously, Nifty 50, everybody knows. Then there is an index called Nifty 100 and there are ETFs and index funds out of it. Now, what is the difference between ETF and index fund also quickly? It's nothing but your underlying stocks, underlying index has, let's say Nifty 50 has 50 stocks. Then the portfolio, the index fund, which is a mutual fund, will mimic your index weightages. Depending upon the market cap, free float market cap, all the stocks will have been given a certain weightage in the Nifty index. According to that weightage, so you know the highest weighted stock. See, the highest market cap, which company is the highest market cap today in India? It used to be Reliance a little while earlier, but Reliance has fallen a lot in this COVID crisis. TCS has, I think, become number one. Yes, TCS is number the highest market cap stock. Second highest is Reliance. Third is HDFC Bank. I think Bobby, that has also fallen a lot. So I don't know after this COVID crisis and all, I have lost my access to my Bloomberg. I don't have it at home. Otherwise, I used to keep myself updated about that. But third is, I think, HDFC Bank. Fourth is HUL. Now, HUL might have become number three, if I'm not wrong, because HUL has risen and risen. HDFC Bank has just fallen. So fourth used to be HUL and fifth HDFC. So let's talk about top five. Now, these are their market cap in descending order. But will there be free float market cap be in this order? No. TCS will be lot below than HDFC Bank and Reliance. Why? Because TCS is, I think, 50-60% owned by Tata Group, which is not free float, which is owned by promoter. So when you are doing a weightage of Nifty, the highest weight will go to HDFC Bank or even, I think, HDFC. Because HDFC is 0% promoter hold. Entire 100% is institutions and retail owners. If somebody did not know this, it might come as a surprise. HDFC Bank is 20-25% owned by HDFC and the remaining 75% is owned by retail and institutions. So indirectly, even that is 100% owned by the institutions. No promoter over there. These Deepak Parekh and all these top big guys over there are not the owners. They are just the CEOs and the chairman and all. Reliance might come on the fourth or the fifth point and hence like that. So what I'm saying is now coming back to how I was explaining your Nifty index. So that let's say there is a Nifty index by Kotak Nifty 50 or an ICICI Nifty 50. Now the fund manager who is sitting at ICICI Nifty 50 has to do nothing. He just has to see, what is the underlying weightage in the Nifty 50, and then mimic the entire thing onto his own fund. What is the benefit out of here is, it's called active versus passive. Someone who is actively taking a call, now this stock will go up, now this stock will go down, which in US it has been seen, it's very, very difficult to do. Because whenever there is someone who is taking these active calls, is actually charging a little money, little higher money, obviously, if you are giving these kind of services. So you have to pay something for it. But if you are just mimicking the index, you are not doing anything value add, no. So you are not even charging anything. So generally, the expense ratio for all these ETFs and index funds, not ETFs, sorry, index funds, comes out to be 0.1-0.2%. That's it. Wo bhi thoda operational expenses cover karne ke liye. So people in US generally have observed that after you deduct all the commissions and tax and everything, probably your passive funds, your index funds fare a little better than your mesh funds. And gradually, I'm telling you guys, in next 5 to 7 to 10 years, in India will also be moving towards this direction only. More and index funds, but they're coming back to the same point. So index fund is kind of a mutual fund of which you buy today and you will be allocated. So all mutual funds, how do they work? If you buy a mutual fund in the market hours, every day in the night around like 10 or 11 p.m., all the mutual fund schemes are updating their NAV. They will update their NAV. NAV is net asset value. So it's just like a share price. Probably they started 10 and then obviously the market is going up, they would be 10.
Vaibhav, I think you're breaking out, Vaibhav. Your voice is coming as a little muffled.
Okay.
Much better. Okay. Yeah.
Better now? Better? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So what I was saying is that every day they calculate, every night they calculate NAVs. So when they're calculating NAVs, you are getting allocated those units. Now let me come at this point to the definitions of SIP, STP, SWP, and STP, whatever I've written over. Now, as I said, nobody knows where the market will go tomorrow or day after, or day after that. Not even Warren Buffett, not even Rakesh Sharma, right? Nobody in the world knows. So if you are a trader, obviously you will take that intraday calls. But if you are not, if you are a long-term investor, which we are talking here about, you do not have to every day sit in front of your screen and time the market that today market is low, let's buy today, tomorrow market is high, let's sell today. No. You are, okay. All right. Lost year, India will move to index fund in next 10 to 10 years due to bad. So what I was saying is that gradually, even India will move towards kind of ETFs and index funds. Now, index funds, what I added after that was that every day all these Kotak Nifty 50, like a Kotak AMC, the fund manager of a Kotak Nifty 50 or an ICICI Nifty 50, they will sit and then calculate the net asset value, which is called NAV. This is published every night around 10 or 11 p.m. It will be reflected on their websites that today, let's say Nifty has moved up by 2%. All the funds, be it a large cap, mid cap, small cap, index funds, all of them, their NAV will be updated. Generally, let's say if a fund is performing very well, then what Nifty is, it's an actively managed fund. Fund manager is taking a call on if there is some fund which has a lot of pharma and FMCG stocks in it, vis-a-vis a fund which has a lot of banking stocks in it. So currently what will happen? The banking sector specific funds will go down even if the market is, let's say, 2% up, even if Nifty is 2% up. Because maybe the pharma or the Reliance or the IT stocks which have done better, they have actually moved up Nifty overall, weighted wise. But because those funds had a lot of banking stocks in it, they have gone down. But there would be funds which have a lot of IT and pharma stocks, more than even the Nifty, they will move up, right? So every day this gets published on their website. Now, you will be allotted those units. Now, in place of shares, like a company, mutual funds are called units. So you will be allocated the units on the night whenever the NAV is published. So now what I am saying is that since nobody knows where the market will go, how much the market will go up, how much the market will go down, if you are a long-term investor, you do not care about the everyday movements. You just know that in the long run, in the 5-year, 10-year, 20-year run, the market has to go up. market has never gone down in a very long time. Yeah, the CAGR of market is generally around 13% to 14% to 15% right from 1990-1995. So you do SIP. What is SIP? If you are getting your salary on 1st of the month, let's say take any date, choose any date. Let's say 2nd of the month. You get salary on 1st. On 2nd of the month, of let's say 20,000 rupees, you buy 20,000 worth of units of, let's say, a Kotak standard multi-cap fund. I'll come into the funds, specific funds later on. So a koi bhi fund you just choose and then buy certain quantity of equal value. So every month you are buying 20,000 worth of Kotak standard multi-cap fund. Now what happens if the market goes up? So Kotak standard multi-cap NAV goes up. You are allocated lesser stock. Let's say the NAV was 20 today. So you will be getting 1,000 units of Kotak standard multi-cap today. But when you are buying it next month or 2nd of May, let's say the NAV has fallen down to 15. So the number of units you will be allocated would be 20,000 upon 15, which is somewhere more than obviously the 1,000 which you had bought last time. So overall, when you buy, keep buying every month, every particular day of every month for a longer time, you have just averaged out your movement of the Nifty. So it's called diversification through time. Correct? Now what happens is, so this has been done, a diversification of time in the long run. Let's say if your investment horizon is 10 years, you will get 120 instances where you are putting in 20,000, or obviously you can increase your capital as well, keep on increasing your capital as your salary increases. After 10 years, when your goal is achieved, you just see what is the current value. Obviously it would be, you would have averaged it a lot, and then probably whatever the current value after that time, 10 years, multiplied by the number of units you have amassed over the past 10 years, that is your capital gains. So this is SIP. SIP is systematic investment plan. So in a particular day, keep buying a particular fund of similar kind of monetary value. So now a little bit of twist here in SIP. So first of all, I have explained you the diversification you are doing by investing into large cap, mid cap, small cap, multi cap, and all. Both of that has been a diversification through market capitalization. Right now, I have also touched upon market the diversification through time. So sometimes what I generally do is, you know, rather than doing a weekly or monthly, I do a weekly. So every Monday, or let's say every Wednesday. Because market is so volatile that you just cannot hold yourself for like a month or two. Maybe on 2nd March, the value was too high. The market started falling from 3rd March. And then till 1st April, it falls. And then 2nd April, it again shoots up. So there's no one. I mean, obviously, I cannot. I'm just being too specific over here. But do as much as diversification as possible, right? So that's one thing. Diversification through time, diversification through through capitalization. And third would be your diversification through product as well. So go for some kind of a fixed income funds and go for equity funds. Kitna ratio, how much percentage allocation should be, that depends upon your asset allocation, which probably we can look tomorrow. Then there are hybrid funds and then there are multi-cap funds. Like let me take first multi-cap fund. Leave it to the fund manager whether multi-cap has all the flexibility. It can invest in large cap, mid cap, small cap, whatever. Right? Only this kind of a fund, multi-cap fund, has this level of flexibility. So the fund manager is not bound by that SEBI regulations. X percentage I have to put in that only. So many people, many novice investors just go for multi-cap. And I go for multi-cap here. I just don't want to leave everything on me. I want to leave everything on my fund manager if I trust him. Let him do, if he sees that mid-cap are going to do well in the next 6 months, let him be overweight on multi-cap. Why are you taking it? Hybrid is generally when you do, Satyam, now I am speaking properly. Hybrid, I hope multi-cap was fine. Hybrid would be generally equity hybrid. So 65% is equities, 35% is debt. You are mixing your portfolio allocation directly in your hybrid fund. Alternatively, what you can do is you can buy both the funds separately, but that would again take a lot of a little bit of an expertise. So for people who are just starting, they can also look at hybrid funds very closely. Now I would want to go into STP. What is STP? STP is a systematic transfer plan. So generally what happens, all the people who are, and most of the people are either students or working over here. So SIP is more important for you guys. But for STP, what happens is that For SIP, every month you are getting salary in your savings account, and from your savings account, that money is going to be invested into mutual funds. In savings account, you get 4% returns mostly. But if you, let's say in March or April or May, generally, if you get a large bonus, so what will you do? You just let keep that money into your savings account and keep doing that SIP? No, that's just completely, you know, it's not giving you great returns, because 4% se jyada to you can, more than 4% you can earn elsewhere, right? So invest entire corpus of your, let's say bonus, let's say 10 lakh ka bonus in one of the liquid fund or an arbitrage fund. I'll explain you what an arbitrage fund is. Liquid fund I have already explained yesterday, so I'm not going there. So you invest some that lump sum money into an arbitrage or a liquid fund, which will give you somewhere around 6-7% or 5-7%. And which is way above your savings account return. And then through that liquid fund, do that SIP. So rather than money going from your savings account, now the money is going from your liquid or an arbitrage account. Right? So you are earning, rather than 4%, you are keep on earning 6% from your for your bonus amount, which is 2% above your normal. And then your SIPs also matter is sorted. So that's a pretty good way to do for a lump sum kind of a thing if you are getting. Generally, for the entrepreneurs, I would generally suggest do STPs, because their cash flow is not fixed, right? So whenever they are getting, just put everything into liquid fund and vahase they can just continue their SIPs, which is the combination will be called STP. Finally, there is SWP. SWP is systematic withdrawal plan. So let's say sometimes for elderly people, the someone was asking 45 years of age dividend and all, so the alternative is SWP. What happens is that you invest lump sum into one place. Let's say invest 10 crores in one fund, and every month you need 30,000, 30,000 out of it for your living, for your sustainability. Currently at your age, at 25, 24, 30, you might not want to do SWP. Probably for your parents, SWP is very good. If you want to give your parents a streamline of like every month, first of the month, you pay, you have to give them 20,000 rupees for their, you know, for their living expenses and all. To put some money, put some 10 lakhs into a liquid fund, and every first of it, just debit 20,000, withdraw 20,000, automatically that goes into your parents' savings account. This you can obviously replicate for yourself when you near the retirement age. So that's SWP, and it's tax. It's actually tax beneficiary compared to the dividend payout after that recent budgetary changes. STEP, I am not getting into that. STEP is generally a modification of STP by some algorithm and all. So let's not get into that and just quickly cover arbitrage and then kind of start wrapping it up. So what happened, guys, is that you know that equity funds are very, very risky, right? Equities are risky. So you have seen what has happened in the last 4-5 years, investments all have fallen to red. But equities actually benefit a little bit from the tax point. If your investment is less than 3 years, your debt funds, like a liquid fund or an overnight or a duration fund, whatever, will actually, you have to pay 30% plus surcharge. I mean, somewhere it comes to be 35-36%, which is your highest tax level actually. Not 30%, but your tax slab. If your tax slab is the highest tax slab, you are going to pay the highest tax slab on the capital gains. But if you want to invest for a shorter term, like this kind of an STP, arbitrage funds will not be as risky, or not at all risky like an equity fund. It's just like it's a debt fund. How that happens is, there is a futures market, futures and options. A future for those particular stock, as I explained you, by definition, it generally trades a little higher than your spot market, which is your current market. Where the fund managers will track that, is there an arbitrage opportunity? Is there a possibility that your arbitrage fund or the future is trading much above practically where it should trade theoretically? If that's the case, they will lock in. There are certain mechanism, I don't want to get into that, but then they have locked in the returns for the entire month. Generally, historically, the arbitrage funds have given 6-7% returns without taking the risk of the equity. The benefit is that the taxation is equity-like. So where you are paying 30% for the highest tax level debt, you are just paying 15% for the equity investment. So this is one of the most preferred methods for a lot of people to do STPs. So this is what I wanted to talk about, the different kind of mutual funds. Mukul, just go to the next page and let's speak for 2-3 minutes and then we'll wrap it up. next slide actually, the time Mukul comes in, next slide actually shows you that how do you, what do you look when you are going to, like which one, that the point which is like which mutual funds you should go for. Yes, ELSS, I mean, ELSS is nothing but ELSS are some designated funds which are investing into equities. They can be large cap, mid cap, small, or not small cap are not there, but large and mid cap and multi cap funds, which are there when you, this anyways they would cover in tax, that ATC requirements. But these are normal equity funds, but will give you a tax benefit. You won't be taxed on this amount till the your limit. So it's nothing different from a normal equity fund. Now that this slide, Nishit, I'll come back on that point later. How to select a mutual fund. So first point which I consider is, most important factor is to decide which kind of fund you want to invest in. So that anyways we have covered, large, mid, small, multi, in the proportion, whatever was discussed. And then just see, first point would be, how old that mutual fund, that AMC is. AMC is an asset management company, like a Kotak or an HDFC. I wouldn't want to get into some mutual fund which is just 2 or 3 years old history. Because I would want to see the fund manager's performance, right? Has the firm fund manager in the past given that kind of an outperformance or not? So I generally look at funds which are at least 10 to 12 years old. And I generally, next step is to see the fund manager's track record. Has the fund manager, and fund manager may not be with the same fund. Let's say there is some fund manager with SBI Mutual Fund today. Maybe he might have shifted from, let's say, Access Mutual Fund just 2 years back. So I would go back to see his actual Access Mutual Fund performance for last 10 years, if he has been there for 10 years. So I'll get an idea as to how he has performed, whatever he has been saying in the media that, okay, I am bullish on pharma. So is he saying he's bullish on pharma? Is it reflecting in his stock picks? Is his portfolio looking like more tilted towards pharma? Or he's saying something else or he's doing something else? If that's the case, that's a red flag. I will never go with that kind of a fund, right? Also, a fund manager will give you an objective initially that, okay, this fund will be invested for this purpose. Whether is it holding that purpose? Sometimes it may take 1 year, 1.5 years to realize, okay, I'm not getting that kind of a fund which were promised and the fund manager is not great. Then probably, okay, TK, after 1 year, you may consider redeeming it and getting into some other funds. But that's fine. I mean, you just cannot get all the information until you do a proper research, thorough research yourself. You might not have access to the fund managers, you know. But being in Edelweiss, being in consistent company with all of these guys, I generally get a lot of views about which kind of fund managers are saying what. So this is the third is past track record. Past track record of the fund, consistency of returns, obviously 1 year, 3 year, 5 year, 7 year, 10 year. These are the ones published. And generally go with the fund which has outperformed over, I mean, consistently. Not like in 1 year it has outperformed very well, but in 5 years it has not been outperforming. I would rather go with preferring 5 year and 7 year outperformance rather 1 year or 2 year or 3 year. Prefer an open-ended, as I already told you, if you follow rating by analyst, opt for fund which has been consistently rated. So more or less, this is what it is. I mean, the first step should be a proper asset allocation, and second, you should pick up right stocks. You should generally go with probably one large cap or an index fund, and two mid cap and two small cap. Why is that? Because, you know, large cap has only kind of 100 stocks to pick up from. So even if you are going to pick two or three large cap funds, more or less the stocks will be same, because generally they have 50 to 60 stocks over there. Right, in those funds. So generally there is a great overlap. Obviously the percentage weightage might differ. I'm not talking about index fund, but actively managed fund. Someone has HDFC Bank has 7%, some might have 9%, but don't know HDFC Bank has. But for mid-cap, because there is a lot of scope, there are 150 stocks in mid-cap, and obviously they can expose themselves to small and large cap as well. And similarly for small cap, there are a lot of stocks, so portfolios can differ a lot. So whenever you are buying two small cap, just compare their portfolio. The portfolios are available for everybody. So compare their portfolios and see if the stocks are not overlapping much. Go for those two stocks. Then you are diversifying across mutual fund, across AMC as well. So diversification across time, diversification across capitalization, and finally diversification across. I know it is a narrow subject. The debt has distracted actually, and I just noted it's level 18 already. So you guys just take your last question and then probably we'll close this for today. Tell us about foreign funds. I would say that do invest in foreign funds. It should be somewhere around 5 to 7% of your portfolio. So there are a few. So either you can invest directly into, let's say, US funds. There are few ways where you can do that. There are websites like Interactive Brokers. There is a website called it starts with V. I'm forgetting all these names. But the other, and I don't prefer, because there are a lot of hidden charges over there when you directly go and buy funds from foreign. But you know, there are ways where you can buy those funds in India itself. Those are called feeder funds. So AMCs like Edelweiss, Franklin, ICICI, a lot of these guys have US funds as well. China fund is only with Edelweiss, if I remember well. So what they will do is that, let's talk about a very interesting fund which has just been launched in India by Edelweiss, which was a US tech fund. So this US tech fund is actually a 20-year-old fund by JP Morgan in US. Now this invests only in the 5 or 6 sectors which are the futuristic sectors. So sectors like 5G, e-commerce, autonomous vehicles, EV, electric vehicles, and all these all futuristic sectors only it will invest in. Now if you talk about, yeah, Invesco's Zarcel is also good. Now if you talk about India, all these companies which are concentrating on these sectors, no, they are not they're not public. They are private companies, so they're startups. So what if I want to invest into those companies and want to earn a good amount of money from this? So there's this fund which will actually mimic whatever is happening in the JP Morgan fund. And now in India, from India, you can invest money in INR through that Edelweiss JP Morgan, Edelweiss US tech fund. And then you can obviously get benefited about that. It's the second fund, which is a Parag Parikh fund. What it does is 65% it invests in Indian equities, 35% it invests in US equity, or in fact, global equities. This is also one of the very good funds which I like. Let's say you are bullish on China. So you want to buy some stocks in China. So this China, Greater China Offshore Fund, which is from Edelweiss again, this will also give you an exposure to you. And this is actually outperformed in the last 1 or 2 months. And probably if you're bullish on China, you should look into this, investing into this kind of a fund. So that's how, and generally do expose yourself with 5 to 7 to 10%, between 5 to 10% into foreign kind of funds. It's a good practice of diversification. So a lot of people have already left. I think we are half the janta now. This was very important, and I am sorry I took 50 minutes, around 45, 50 minutes, because it was very important. I hope this recording is done and people do listen to it before coming to the session tomorrow. Mukul, can you just please put that in the group? Because we will build upon whatever has been discussed today for the mutual fund in order to make that asset allocation and taxation thing and all those things. I don't know if I have missed any questions. I did not scroll back on the chat and all. Amit, you know how the economy is shaping up, right? And the world is shaping up. Sometimes you would think that, okay, China is doing all these things, rather than just keep on cursing China. Okay, wo bhi karo. You can do that as well. But also you can look to make some money also out of it. So if you think that, okay, China is going to do good, and because I read a lot, I mean, what kind of research is just, I read research papers. Yeah. I read zerohash.com is a wonderful website. There are I keep reading economist.com. Economist is a wonderful place. Market Watch is there. There's a lot of good foreign websites as well. And I get access to Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley, JP Morgan reports, global reports. So that's what my profession is. So I keep on doing that stuff. That is why I am a little bullish on. And bullish on in the sense, I would invest like a maximum of 10% divided between US tech fund and a China fund, to be very honest. Not more than that. So let's close it, guys. All of us will be tired now. I told about Parag Parikh fund. So Parag Parikh, I like a lot. The fund manager is very down to earth. Rajiv Thakkar, he's a pretty nice guy. Very nice, very nice. PPFAs, I have no doubts here. You should definitely do an SIP. Yes, definitely.
Nice.
Thanks, Amit.
So
yes, you should hold, Sumant. You should definitely hold and keep investing. Don't stop. Keep investing in PPFAs.
So Vaibhav, should we wrap up?
Wait a second. Why would he get jailed? Yeah. Have you done something else? Something like a criminal? I don't know if that's the case. So, okay, if you know any insider information, you can get real. Please ping me. I also want to know, and I'll give a cell call on that. No. Parag Parikh is dead for many years now. That fund has been managed by Sir Neil Parikh and the fund manager Rajiv Thakur. Don't worry about all those things.
So actually, there is a book also by Parag Parikh called Stocks to Riches. One called Behavioral Finance and Investing. But I would suggest that everybody at least read Stocks to Riches. It's a very good read, very short read, not too much when I say 200 pages or so. But yeah, like it's written wonderfully, and you guys should at least read. I think it gives a very wonderful session about a wonderful overview about investing and all. But Vaibhav, almost 11:25, guys, so let's wrap up today. Hope you liked it. We enjoyed a lot. I think it was a really passionate kind of a discussion between all the three of us. But hope you join us tomorrow as well. Bye-bye.
Good night, guys. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.